It's a auspicious day today. Should we how should we inaugurate this episode? Should we wish Hemant again as we have done off our recording, or do you not want us to
You know,
reveal?
we are good. We are not making a big deal out of it. You shouldn't
Oh,
either.
it's oh.
No, but how can we not, considering the movies we are talking
Considering the
about?
movies
That's
we
why.
are.
Let me escape. Give me this grace.
Okay. But you, I think you, I don't think I'll be able to resist making a joke when we get to Eyes Wide Shut
To
in
Eyes
only
Wide
this.
Shut.
Yeah,
Yes,
but
100%.
yeah,
Oh man.
so
Oh man.
yeah, this
It's
is basically a counterbalance, right? Today is the
yes,
like, you know,
yeah.
anniversary.
I'm gonna keep saying happy thoughts before midnight, before midnight, before midnight. Worst case
Yeah.
scenario.
Anyways, today I don't know, but I think we'll keep this. But today, we are going to be talking about a lot of. I forgot to say hello, hello, hello. But hello, hello, hello! Welcome to today's podcast, our third episode in the Stanley Kubrick saga, Odyssey, whatever. We've done the Odyssey joke. I couldn't think of another.
Somewhat delayed also because
Yeah, I was about to say, like, we I don't know if we should apologize for being this delayed or just being that, you know. I think the pairings of movies we chose, we realized there's like just so much to talk about in some of them that I think it's a good, I think a month break maybe between our first two episodes and the last two episodes you'll be getting, because we are going to, we have planned at least to successively record the final episode of the Kubrick stuff in this month itself, which will involve discussion about 2001 A Space Odyssey, at least that. AI maybe tangentially we'll talk about, or we'll bring it in, depending on how much we have to talk about 2001. But today's episode is the trickiest episode in some ways to tackle, I feel, both in terms of the subject matter and the timing on which we are recording it and when we watched it
timing
and
both from personal fronts as well as country front,
social front.
social
Yeah,
front, lots of fronts. Yes. we didn't watch these movies when the world was hunky dory.
Yes.
We're watching them
When is
when
the world
the
hunky dory is
shits.
the other question. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Uh,
No,
in
the world has legitimately we
gone
were
to shite.
ignorant.
Yeah, the
Yeah,
world has legit
we were
gone to shite.
kids.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, but no, but I think today's episode is, I don't know how to title it yet, but I've written down Kubrick the Provocateur, because I think that's in some ways these three films are the ones which I feel are him being the most overtly provocative. At least one of them is most definitely that, but even I think two of them are most definitely that. That is, and then even the third one now, even if it feels tame, like it's more to do with, it's more within the bounds of societal norms, it still feels like it's playing with, playing with them as opposed to staying within them. But today we are going to essentially be discussing three films from three different decades. One of them is Lolita, which released in 1962, which is essentially the film which Kubrick wanted to make but was supposed to not make until he did Spartacus, the lovely, lovely film we discussed in our Ah,
previous
yes.
episode.
Ah, yes, I had forgotten that movie. Yes.
You had forgotten it. Okay.
Yes, I had
It's
forgotten
hard
why
to
I talked
forget.
about this.
It's hard to forget how long that movie was. But anyways, we'll be talking about Lolita today first, which is also a very, I would say, an overlong film, which runs at 153 minutes. Then there's a
Didn't feel that way, though, to be
really
very
okay.
honest.
I
Yeah,
this
I
this
didn't feel much.
on a rewatch, the second half, just I was just like, this is going on and on and on. I was just like, come on. But anyways,
Yeah,
yeah.
even in the first watch it was bad. The
Okay.
rewatch was more painful.
Okay.
I finished all my laundry. I finished all the dishwashers,
Okay.
everything, and still it was going on. And
Okay.
You'll
start to gauge the opinions of the.
I think one of the reasons why I didn't feel too bored, because I was more like on pins and needles, because I wanted to see how Kubrick is going to handle this.
Sure,
because
the material, the, because it's yeah. spiky material during. Okay,
spiky is an understatement.
We'll talk about this in detail, of course, when we go into our. Just for the intro, we're talking about Lolita, of course. We're talking about A Clockwork Orange, which is 1971. This was made after 2001, right? A Space Odyssey.
Yes.
And this is basically when he wanted to make Napoleon, didn't get to make it. So basically made the most confrontational and angry film of his career, probably.
Basically, Sara Bharas utar diya us movie.
Exactly. Everything, the fact that Napoleon couldn't be made is sort of filtered through the anger and disgusting, essentially, acts of violence, both sexual and physical in A Clockwork Orange. A lot talk about that film, of course. And I think that's the most popular out of the three films which we're going to be talking about. And
also,
the third
one, also, I think the more one, some of the most misunderstood.
Which I think you can, like, it's the type of film which is sort of, you know, you can come at it from very different points of view and you can take out different things from it, which would all be somewhat justifiable, I feel. Because there's a lots of, it's not an easy film at all. None of these are. But this is the least of the three. Like, you kind of just, there's no solution in the film, essentially, right?
All three of them.
I feel that in the other two, there are parts which sort of tell you what, you know, the director's thinking, at least. In this, I feel it's just a bit...
It's almost
world.
Stream of consciousness in a way. It's like his anger is towards everything.
Yeah.
I don't like this part of British society. I don't like this. I don't like that. I don't like this. I don't like you. I don't like you. I'm like, we get it, Stan.
Yeah.
Calm down.
But
okay.
We get it.
Are you okay?
Yeah.
Are you okay, Stan?
It's okay. You cannot be okay. Not being okay is
imagine
fine.
Imagine Stanley Kubrick going to therapy. If you imagine in
he's the ultimate meme of men will make movies instead of going to therapy. He's the meme.
Are you scared? Are you scared of your pedophilic thoughts? Make shining. Are you cynical about the government? Go ahead, make
Dr. Strangelove. Yeah. Exactly.
Might have been very late in his actually marriage too, so I think that speaks a loads of things.
I was about to make that very cliched joke that are you angry that no one credited you for faking the Apollo moon landings? So that's a conspiracy theory. Sorry for anyone who's sort of toppled over into it here and just believed that. Okay, sorry. But that is a conspiracy theory. Anyways, and the third film we are going to be talking about, which I will say that Hemant is going to be on the defensive for. And I am going to actually be the more, like, strangely enough, the middle person here, considering I came into this episode thinking I really don't like the film, but I actually kind of didn't. I liked it a little bit more the second time, which is not the case with Amartya, who really didn't like it. This is Eyes Wide Shut, 1999, which has the weirdest reputation of being one of the great overlooked Kubrick films, which it still baffles me a little bit. But anyways, we'll get into it.
Nolan termed this as the 2001 of marriage movies. I am like, you are becoming too pretentious at this point. You need to calm down.
Nolan is becoming pretentious.
Nolan becoming pretentious. Just imagine. 2001 of marriage movies. Kehna kya chahte ho?
But that kind of is also explaining some of the coldness which sort of seeps into it, I suppose. But whatever. Anyways, we'll be talking about these films, all of them. I guess there's a trigger warning because there's a lot of discussions about at least in A Clockwork Orange and Lolita.
Extreme trigger warning. Yeah. Extreme trigger warning, especially considering the current state of the world and the fact that three men are talking about this sort of stuff. Yeah. Extreme trigger warning.
We apologize also. Weirdly enough,
soft and hard boundaries. That's, I think, maybe then.
I actually feel like comfortable talking about Kubrick's films, just like as the whole, you know, when you talk about, even when he touches on these subjects. I feel because a lot of his films are always oriented towards men. Like, they are pointing the needle at men only most of the time. Like, I don't think they are which will probably prompt a discussion, because I have a bunch of questions and maybe we'll answer them as we discuss these films. But I'll ask these questions as of now, and then you guys can even give me one word answers or one word whatever the titles of the films, if you want to, as to what you think about these. But I think this can like just make like an overarching thing for our episode and make it briefer than we usually do our episodes, because all of us are in a hurry, it seems. So my questions are, first was empty provocations or fruitful provocation? And so you can sort of decide which ones of these films, these three films, are there on, you know, on those levels. Which one do you think actually merit having, like, you know, provoking the way they do, and which one don't? The other one is, what is the purpose of these provocations? Does one need to see them or enjoy them to get punished by them? Which I think is the sort of, you know, again, because this was the question I asked myself most while watching A Clockwork Orange. And I think that film answers it in the second half. Like, the first half of that film is an onslaught. And an onslaught which you do have to wonder, why am I here watching it sometimes? But that's the big question, I think, is, and this might be not the type of question which we should answer, but I think it's important in the context of these films. What role do women play in these films? Because they are all in some way centered around the woman as an object of ridicule, more than ridicule, just violence.
Because I mean, you can clearly, like, you can, if you go very much ahead in the movie, maybe that's most fresh in my mind, as was the when he was in the hospital and he was given, the psychiatrist comes in and gives him the drawings. And everything seems okay until the woman comes into the drawing. He has that, like,
it's a Clockwork Orange, right?
Mm. Yeah, misogyny, in Clockwork Orange.
Yeah.
And I think Eyes Wide Shut, you can almost clearly see it, when how he talks to his affair, really. It is like he kind of very much gaslights her, like, into like believing that he's actually going to prioritize her and everything.
So I mean, again, I think with the interesting thing with Eyes Wide Shut, and I, to an extent, even A Clockwork Orange, is how much can you satirize the world, but also somewhat tip, like, I feel they are almost tipping over into embodying that satirization also, which is the tricky line you have to pull off sometimes, but we'll talk about that. And then last question I had written here, which we might answer, which we might not, is there an intersection of sex and violence there in all three of these films? If so, how are they entangled and how do they interfere with their characters' lives? Which, again, I think they will automatically be answered as we talk about each of these films, because they are inherently linked, I think, in all three of them. But just before, I guess, we start the discussion about all this, I guess it's perfect to kind of have a quote from Stanley Kubrick, who kind of encapsulates, again, like, I think this is basically us in these episodes, it's encapsulating what Stanley Kubrick's worldview is, again and again. But this is what he said with respect to A Clockwork Orange, but I think applies to like all of them, is, man's capacity for violence is an evolutionary hangover which no longer serves a useful purpose, but it's there all the same. So kind of applies to all three, I feel like, just this idea that no one needs that desire or impulse to do what these people do, but it is there. And I think they are all, I think all these films are sort of tapping into these impulses, these desires, obsessive desires, especially of all the male protagonists in all these films, and sort of, you know, countering them or you can argue promoting them. I don't know.
Think he's promoting them, because the gaze itself doesn't feel like some self-glorifying gaze or anything like that.
It's not animal.
It becomes self-glorifying the length of it. I think that's mostly
That's the most.
A glimpse of it is more than enough to like sell the idea. I think it was. This seemed like I saw almost everything of his in. I tried to watch it really hard in chronology, is that when I was watching, like, 2001, I watched Clockwork Orange right after that. Mm-hmm. So the pace of his, like, you know, like the kind of mood he gets you into.
Oh yeah, there's definitely like, it's like some parts specific... of his set have transferred from one place to another.
Yeah,
I mean the whiteness, you mean like the white and pink, that pink, that specific pink. I always,
it's like I'm very unnatural, like it's like like a bit disturbing. Like I this is in a praiseworthy way because that movie is supposed to be disturbing. Yeah. But
it's kind of cutting your eye. Like we can we can get into it if you start, I mean, from Lolita actually, because he goes far, like in this or the scene lengths and stuff, he goes really,
definitely.
With Clockwork Orange compared to Lolita, like
because after Lolita he made, I think we were talking, Amartya and me, that he made Doctor Strangelove, which is like the most compact, like really like 90 minutes.
I think that's what we talked about on Doctor Strangelove also. Like after Lolita, he's like, I want to make something entirely different from this.
Well, it's not though, because it's more dirty than Lolita, which is like the weird thing about
cheeky. Like, see his cheekiness. Like I think his cheeky to scary scale.
His
cheekiness. And
he's very good at the cheeky. Yeah, he's very good at the cheeky aspect. Yeah.
And when he gets scary, like when he gets scary, when it goes very like that, you tip over the, you know, the 45 degree X is equal to Y line.
Yes.
I'm gonna turn this into a math lesson.
Yeah, I was about to say, this is like the engineering.
This is engineering.
Yes. You'll find that whenever it like tips over, it's always like it's always like a character moment. Like halfway through the movie, most of the time, he will kind of like go tip over to like, okay, oh no, this guy was the general, you know, the reveal of like. His bodily fluids was in the
Jack
part
the Ripper,
of the movie.
Yes. Yeah.
And that part is when you start thinking, okay, these guys are, none of them have it. It's always successive scenes of this, of like characters finding out that, oh God, these guys are crazy. Like, they're surrounded by crazy people.
Absolutely. I guess Lolita is, as you said, a good point to start in that way, because I think I think Lolita is one of the more popular novels at that time that came out, and it was very controversial, banned in America, which is why no one wanted to produce a version of it when Kubrick and his, say again and again, his pedo producer wanted to make the movie, but I forgot his name. I think it's James Harris.
James B. Harris, right?
James B. Harris. Yeah.
I heard a disturbing news also. Ki apparently, Sue Lyon, who played Lolita, was actually in a relationship with the guy during the shooting of the movie. So
it's a bit. It's very, very tricky terrain. A very uncomfortable terrain. Which weirdly enough, I didn't feel through the watching the movie this time, which I was grateful for in some ways. Because I feel the film is so, at the end of the day, so condemning of the guy, or at least it's so cosmically tragic towards him that it's almost like, okay.
It's not even condemning. The fact that he's trying to be so implicit about it, not showing everything, but he's also treating it like some sort of a, like saxophone blaring, like love story of the ages.
Yeah.
It's almost like the satire is going full bloom at that point.
Yeah.
He's making fun of that entire thing. He's like, what are you, this is ridiculous. It's almost like Kubrick is saying, this is ridiculous to the guy. What are you doing? What are you doing with your life?
But it's so, so this is what I was saying. Just to set the film up, I've taken this. If you want my pithy or like stupid title alternatives, I have written Dr. Zem for How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love Hebephilia.
Listen, didn't you have a daughter? Didn't you have a daughter with a lovely name? Yeah, a lovely, what was it now? A lovely lyrical lilting name like,
Lolita.
She is a lovely girl, you know, it's a swing, you know, it's a jazz, and she has got a curvature which I take a lot of notice of.
Hegophilia, which I realized is
Jesus Christ,
a love for puberty. Like, I didn't know this was a word, I just thought we say pedophilia, but anyways, it's about sexual attraction towards adolescents, who are entering adolescence. Anyways, that's my bad description of it. But the otherwise, the other plot description is Humbert, one of the great names.
Humbert, or the amount of times Humbert says Hamburg.
Yeah,
that should be the title at this point.
Yeah, no, but it's like there's a litany of great names in this also. Like there's a Mr. Swine who's the night manager, and I'm like, this is like you're making a farce here, essentially, right? So. Humbert is a middle-aged British novelist who is both appalled by and attracted to the vulgarity of American culture when he comes to stay at the boarding house run by Charlotte Hayes. It's a boarding house. Run by Charlotte Hayes. This is played by the magnificent Shelley Winters. He soon becomes obsessed with Lolita, played by Sue Leon, who didn't do many Did she act a lot after this?
She acted on a lot of Z movies. Which basically means B grade ke niche. So she
and they wanted to make a star out of her, him and Mr. Harris. So when he stays at the
to be honest, she's impressive.
She's very good in this.
As a child actress, she's impressive.
When he comes to, the Humbert character becomes obsessed with Lolita, the woman's teenage daughter, and then everything sort of unravels from there in the film. It's written, the sole writing credit for the film is given to Vladimir Nabokov, who wrote the novel. Though I was reading a book we have referenced again and again in this series, the Kubrickian Odyssey, that there's very little of his screenplay actually used in the actual movie. It's a lot to do with taking ideas from other writers who he had sourced before and adding his own elements. The only, I think, big thing is that a lot of the war refugee elements of like the background of the Humbert character sort of removed, which sort of makes him even more of a cipher, I feel, and more of a creep in some ways. But yeah, I think the big challenge before Lolita was to make it somewhat palatable to the producers to actually be able to like finance it, because it was such a controversial film. Still is, I think, in many ways. Though, of course, it's the way it's directed and the way it's integrated is what we're going to talk about and why that's a special thing. So, yeah.
I think I should have seen the Adrian Lyne movie once before, after this,
which is all explicit.
Yep, yep.
Sure. And how did they do the casting? Do you know of that film? Or
No, I have no idea. All I know is that Jeremy Irons plays the Humbert.
He would make a good Humbert.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
He has that quiet pain to him. Like
Yes.
Slimy but also. He can be slimy.
He can be very slimy. He was in Dead Ringers. He was great in Dead Ringers. So
Did you guys ever see James Mason in any other movie before watching?
I've seen him in Westerns. Yeah. Magnificent Seven, if I'm not mistaken.
Leagues Under the Sea. If you go from that to Lolita, it makes Captain Nemo very creepy. Like you can't see it the same way anymore. You feel like, are you okay
thing is very critical, I think, to Lolita, right? Like because his performance communicates that really well. Like I feel he is it's not very creepy. It's the modulation of the creepy. It's like you're always a bit repulsed by him. Like I was at least a bit, you know.
He's seedy. He comes off as desperate very, very easily. Like, and you can kind of see that. I think that there was like a stage direction.
It's the current climate of incels, basically. 60s mein in logon ko hi incels kehte the.
Isn't he more like a producer figure in some ways also? Like, because he's in a position of power, right? Compared to somewhat of a position of power. Well, with Lolita, he's definitely, but with Shelley Winters, not as much.
I think he revels in being in that position of power, even though he knows that he is not emotionally equipped to be in a position of power just by default, because he doesn't have that strong of a personality. So he has to, you know, manipulate from beginning to end. I think the twist, you can't call it a twist, I think the entire point of the movie is the fact that Lolita herself becomes wise to the manipulations and manipulates him for her own ends.
Yeah.
Whether that is freedom, whether that's more or less freedom. It's like taking her agency from him in a way.
Yeah.
Whatever she does and how the movie progresses, that's essentially her trying to take agency from this ultimately meek man who for some reason is in love with her. So.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that is shown in actions, but it's not like the movie never goes away from him from James' perspective.
Yeah,
which is why I think Sue Lyon is
like
very good.
Showing you the problem and showing how he's like unaware of his disconnected from reality.
Yes,
like
yes,
I like that way of
that's a fascinating filmmaking choice also, na? That's a fascinating filmmaking choice. Mm-hmm. That's a fascinating filmmaking choice because you are not showing the directly, you're not explicitly showing them, you know, having sex or whatever.
Right.
You can't show that.
Yeah.
But you are showing the disconnect for the guy.
Some of the insinuations are absolutely brilliant though. Yeah. Like the way it's, which is why the coding's the one brief advantage of the various coding or whatever the production code at that time was, that you found inventive ways of implication. Like, you know, you knew how to use the...
Right.
And I don't mean the flowers mingling together nonsense. Mm-hmm. I mean, like...
Even
the opening image is so like, evocative. Like, somewhat seedy, of course, with the leg... With her feet, And,
him
inserting cotton wools inside, like, each of her toenails. And, polishing them. And it's just, like, so
and
disturbing,
that,
but also, like...
Yeah, it is.
Yeah,
and I like how his notice that his like body language completely changed when he got into the room, where he suddenly turned into he's like trying to like vibe with her. And
yes.
Hey girl, like, he's trying to do that.
Yes, exactly.
And
it becomes
more creepy. Yeah.
It's the Steve Buscemi meme, right? Hello, fellow kids. It's kind of that. Hello, fellow kids.
But I feel, for me, it's basically a film of two halves, essentially, until Shelley Winters is there and until after she leaves the film. I think.
Interesting that this is a Kubrick thing we have seen in at least three movies.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Even Full Metal Jacket we discussed, right?
Yeah.
And then what else was there?
This one,
Barry Lyndon. I mean, Barry Lyndon had like
Barry Lyndon.
I think
that's
good.
Part one, part
halves,
two
yeah.
only. Yes,
yeah. Barry Lyndon definitely has halves. Spartacus itself has his own issues, but Spartacus
that doesn't have halves. That has
quarters.
That is four. I would say four parts. You can say
that's a four part sequence. Yeah,
my halves feel like four parts. Also, a different thing.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry. Not anymore. Spartacus slander. I suppose.
Yeah, I think no more slander to any of his own movies.
Yes.
Yes.
I think this is really grounded Kubrick. In maybe in heaven he must be like just like or hell, I don't know, like like he.
No, it's fine.
He,
when you say
he
heaven or
like,
hell, that's
like,
the sort of irony he goes for, I think, all the time. So it's okay. Like
he'll
be probably in hell only.
Even Kubrick, in hell must be feeling like, that's what that's like. Okay then,
not bad. Yeah.
The weather is not bad. I'm though not even cold, okay? I'm not even I'm feeling fine. You guys are just complaining.
Yes.
I think the Lolita thing for me is like, it's the Shelley Winters and when she leaves. Because I think James Mason, I think, is as you guys said, terrific performance. I think perfectly pathetic is what I had noted down.
Yes,
like,
yes.
You know, very, very few people can be as... Because he's not...
As delusional also.
Because I was reading... One of the things I was... Because a lot of the biography, like they were noting, and Kubrick said that if he had his way, this would be... Like, we would have to go from somewhere being repulsed by him to being somewhat sympathetic towards him. And I was like, I was never sympathizing towards him. Let's be very clear.
Absolutely
like, you know?
Not.
And I don't know if the film ever does sympathize. Like, there's that one moment where he cries profusely in front of Lolita towards the end, which I can get. And I was like, okay, that's a very interesting, you know, the push and pull between them. But
is that the scene towards the end where
he goes to meet her with the sweetest looking man named Dick? Again, like, brilliant use of irony throughout, you know, like, it's just, anyways.
I also think if he wanted to be sympathetic to her,
to
James Mason's character, I think he would have used a close-up, right, towards his face when he's like breaking down and everything. He doesn't do that. He maintains that shot.
It's all in wide angle. It's all in the master.
The epilogue has like that weight of like being a cosmic joke. It has like, it's like he shoots Quilty's character, and then it's like epilogue. Humbert died by the heart attack waiting for this, the end. I'm just like, oh, okay. You know, it's like, you don't have like a proper...
It's the Looney Tunes cartoons kind of. that's all, fucks.
Yeah. It's Barry Lyndon ended with something like that, right? Like now they are all equal. Just like, okay.
I think Barry Lyndon's ending with, at least how it ended with like a, it's almost, you know, like how that feeling comes when you had same feeling with There Will Be Blood in the end. It feels like a overture, and then I don't know what the reverse of an overture is, like what the closing
on track on track or something.
Encore? In the end you would expect some kind of like, you know,
She gets redemption, I think. He doesn't.
Yeah, they gave her an ending, which was nice. I like that. At least in the, I thought that maybe that would have been.
I think stealthily, he's also showing, he's giving the woman an agency, even though the circumstances of her attaining agency is so messed up.
You can say she never attains agency, considering she essentially gets pushed. Exploited first by Mason's character, and then essentially by Dr. Zem, for whatever that prick's name is in the film.
Quilty. I think this opens up. I think this was more like a, I mean, you can look at it in the same way as you look at any of, like, if you look at it in like the full Metal Jacket way, she was the baldy, or the not baldy, she was Joker.
Gomer.
She has been given only this kind of life, right? Like, and then that's exactly what she will think, that oh, this is how the world works, especially
yes
at that
exactly
so, yeah, that's a very interesting comparison. I just never viewed her
her entire perspective, her entire perspective becomes skewed because of what she goes through from the beginning.
Except I don't know, I feel the presence of Shelley Winter's character sort of offputs her as the submissive, because it's for me she gives the most nakedly emotional performance here.
She's the moral construct, right?
Because all of them are obsessed with each other, essentially, right? Like, she's obsessed with Humbert is obsessed with Lolita. Lolita is obsessed with Quilty. Quilty is obsessed with
Kailash Khair's Toba, Toba, Toba.
See, I never thought Lolita say we will be connecting to
Kailash Khair.
Kailash Khair. Yeah, I mean, we can connect him.
Kailash Khair, okay, clearly. Not the real Toba Toba, not these meme ones.
but Kailash Khair in general,
Kailash
can connect
Khair,
with.
We can connect with, yes.
Yes, just because of the content of the film. So.
Toba Toba Toba.
Power imbalance is the whole point, right? That is the whole thing that is existing throughout. I think it exists here, it also exists in Eyes Wide Shut. Eyes Wide Shut is basically Tom Cruise searching for a power balance.
He wants the upper hand. He's realized that Nicole Kidman has destabilized his sense of authority and power by telling him that women can be pervy too, essentially.
Sir Chutia character. We all get it. Stanley was like, two ghantes, he was like trying to tell us that guy is an idiot.
Which Stanley Kubrick male character isn't an idiot is the other question, right? Because most of them are. That's his whole thing, I feel, a lot of time.
Like, I think the only person who is not an idiot, but that is also because he's like extremely moral and extremely naive, is the Colonel from Paths of Glory.
Yeah, that's the aberration to his filmography, I feel. It's like, you know, it's like, what is Paths of Glory doing in Kubrick's filmography apart from...
I mean, I think for him, okay, I mean, if you want to look at his, like, world... I mean,
Spartacus is also that then, but yeah.
Spartacus is also technically an idiot only. Banda banda revolution ke hal pe Roman Empire ke piche ja raha hai, sir.
This is basically you making the same comment that probably Kubrick made to Dalton Trumbo script.
Yes.
But okay, yeah, anyways, I mean, you were saying, Hemant,
His decisions on in Paths of Glory and Spartacus are more driven by script, really. He's got no control over
yeah.
it.
Yeah, 100%.
Here, at least he had some control over it because the script itself is messed up. So
yes.
he doesn't have to.
So
he
he's like, I have to do something.
A lot of the heavy lifting is done by that.
Yeah, yeah. I have to do something. He's
For him, I think, like, for his whole deal with the movie was just staging. Like, he knows context-wise, these guys know, people know what the power dynamic is.
Yes.
And all he has to do is give irony to it. Everything is ironic. Like, even...
Yep.
Like all of his, like, when he talks to Shelley Winters, and you can clearly see him like getting quieter and quieter as she gives speaking.
You know,
and
if you remove
kind of find his like inner psyche, you kind of see the trailing off and like having some, you know, the fantasizing kind of reality his generation will have.
I think there is a criticism that could be afforded to Lolita. Mm. It is sending off all the, you know, extremely provocative and extremely potent ideas that the novel might want to show.
Mm.
But also, if people were wondering whether it is ironic or not, I think there is a scene in the hotel which basically shows Humbert trying to steady a cot.
Oh, cot,
and what is occurring is basically a Looney Tunes skit.
Yeah, it is genuinely that. For the longest time, for like
longest time, it becomes a Looney Tunes skit. And after that, what happens with Lolita and him, with Lolita stating about a game she played at camp with the guy.
At Camp Climax. Sorry,
Camp
I have to
Climax.
Mention that.
If
you don't think that's irony, if you don't think that's implication, I don't know what to tell you. It's like, at that point, he has already proved it to you. Okay?
Yeah.
This is the extent to which I can push.
Yeah. I mean, there's some really, like, there's also, I think I've written down one of the things is... like, even when, like, you know, Charlotte is the Shelley Winters character, when she asks Humbert when he's basically deciding to take on to the lodge or like the boarding house, like he's deciding to stay there. She's like,
what was the decisive factor? My garden?
Things was your cherry prize.
And then the film cuts at that moment to a close-up of Lolita looking at the two. I was like, you know, you can do all the sort of sexual innuendo through
things. I mean, he literally says cherry pies.
Cherry pies, yeah, exactly. And then there's the image of, I think, them first time sort of, they're in his room / office where she's serving him the breakfast. Like, Lolita has to serve him the breakfast. And the film, like, holds on the moment and cuts exactly when she is like making him eat an egg and he holds her hand. And I'm just like, you know, you get like these really striking moments of tension between them. And then the later ones are less.
It's also tension between a filmmaker trying his best to depict a very complicated story as, you know, purely as possible, with as less of a compromise as possible. You can feel the tension even within the film itself.
Yeah, I think the film would lose a lot if actually, because Kubrick always didn't like the fact that he couldn't make Lolita much more explicit and vulgar, which I would think would make some, which would lose or at least reduce the power of it in terms of giving whatever sort of agency it has to the Lolita character, especially because in this, with Sue Leon's performance also, she feels almost in power most of the time, or almost knowing of what
because
is
she
happening.
Does right
yeah.
because she does right and yeah
See,
and that's
I mean,
what
I think, like in the time that it came out, this is like the equivalent of femme fatale character because
almost
were,
yes
like,
almost
trying
yes.
to make her I mean, in this case, like he is the horrible murderer. But in this case, like at least like how much she's exposed to him, the more you can kind of see how like she kind of becomes more of her own character rather than someone who's
exactly
mm-hmm.
because you'll see that even when as she's like consoling him, it's not really a console, a consolation of like, yeah. It seems like a problem, bro. Like,
yeah.
Like
no, yes. She's always like, she's almost seems like she's always mocking him, which he is doing yeah. consistently to Shelley Winters, which is, you know, it's the whole, the cycle of thing, which is why I think the first half of it, I really, really like, because it's like, you get this very parasitic relation between these three people. And then she yeah. distances herself from the daughter because she wants to be with this man who wants to be with the daughter. And it's like, you know, yeah. it's really
it's
uncomfortable.
Extremely messed up. Yeah, it's extremely yeah. messed
and
up.
And it happens in one scene there, which is...
That whole sequence with the... it's like Chekhov's gun or whatever you
Chekhov's
want to
say. Chekhov's gun, completely. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That whole setup is behavior, absolutely yeah. terrific.
It, I nice think, microcosm. Yeah. I really... Yeah. That is yeah. like most Kubrickian thing. Like he'll yeah. show everything in like a very concentrated way. Yeah. But it's fun. It's fun going. He kind of details everything bit by bit after that. Like,
yeah.
They kinda, like they. I liked how. I mean, I felt that they did Shelley Winters dirty in one sense is that they never gave her they gave her a scene of like showing her struggles with the relationship.
Yeah.
But they never showed a reaction to what happened later on. It was more just like kind of.
But I feel that's the joke almost. It's almost like no, like everything falls into place for him. Like it's the quote unquote perfect murder for him. Because it's like yeah. he doesn't commit it. She gets into an accident because of his emotional devastation, I suppose. But, you know, then this Lolita music starts playing exactly in the next scene. Like the Lolita, yeah. The one which is the theme of it. When yeah, he's in the bathtub and everyone is like, oh, you took the gun because you're thinking of killing yourself. And...
Yeah, it's all a big fat
no,
joke.
No, he didn't say anything. That's the thing. He doesn't have to say anything. He's so protected. Maybe the great...
male privilege conversation.
Yeah. Yeah. If you want to make this statement.
Because she, to me, always struck as a tragic yeah. character. Even though, of course, she's very clingy and she can be very annoying. But she is... Like
no, but she's
desperate.
Also quite tragic. She's quite tragic.
She's
also.
Very tragic.
I think for her, it was like the emptiness in the relationship that kind of made her that way.
Yeah.
I think like her, that's why you need those kind of moments for like a character like that, especially to seem more. You need to have more than like a one note character for it to turn out to being just a one note character.
Yeah.
Yeah. She has two dimensions for.
Oh
at
yeah,
least
yeah.
One. I don't think she's fleshed out.
The one character who I think like Kubrick gives way more time than I think is necessary is the Peter Sellers Quilty character.
Quilty character. That is him. That is the script developing only. That was not in the
yeah because it
book.
Was because in the book like Quilty is just a presence. Like he is the person who is following them, but they don't know anything about him.
Yeah.
There is no information about him in the book. Apparently. He is not there as a presence at all. Like
in this, he's doing as you said, the Doctor Strangelove.
He's doing the
audition
tape. This is his audition tape for Doctor Strangelove. That Doctor Zephyr character is basically like, what?
Yes.
What are you doing?
I mean, it is freewheeling, and in a sense, like I like some of the bits with Sellers himself. It's just that I was like. Really like that much like I'm just like cut. I like it wasn't an uncomfortable why aren't you cutting, it's like you're letting the scene go
you're
on for that long
on. Yeah
I'm
yeah.
like I thought we could like you know hone this into a 2 hour 10 minute at least movie and this just has like that like
one
flab to it.
Yeah, one fantastic scene in Lolita that still stays with me is him rushing to the hospital.
Oh yeah, it's really good. That's the whole noir thing actually also where it comes into play.
In the shadows where the guards actually stop him and he falls to the ground and the camera is looking at him from the back and you can't see anything except his silhouette as he's on the ground.
Yeah.
It's a fantastic shot and it's just so good.
It's shot by Oswald Morris, who's I think a British cinematographer who also didn't get along well with Stanley Kubrick, surprise. I think only Anthony Harvey, the editor, got on well with him in this film, at least. I think
he used to interact the least with him, and already the work is done mostly. So
because he used to be the editor for most of
it. Yeah, Kubrick will already know exactly where he's gonna cut. He'll just tell you. It's the easiest job ever.
Yeah.
Yeah. Every time Anthony Harvey would listen here कि Stanley Kubrick का movie he has to work at, he's like हाँ ठीक है आधा से ज़्यादा काम तो हो ही जाएगा मुझे कोई काम करना नहीं है
I'll come with some tape. That's
yeah, basically yeah.
I'll bring the tape. You, he'll have the editing machine.
But yeah, and I also think this is one of the few films in which I actually think that it has two really well written, to really like strong in a you know, they are vulnerable. They have their, they might not have agency in the case of someone like Shelley Winters, but they have in the case of Lolita in a very perverse way. But I feel out of the three movies, I feel this movie is actually the most successful in creating female characters who do counterbalance the male perspective also. Like, of course, there is that in Eyes Wide Shut. It's just the balance of Nicole Kidman being in it and Tom Cruise being in it is like a bit lopsided, in my opinion. So
that's why I was wondering why Anthony Harvey's name is so familiar.
Why? He, what happened?
No, he's the editor of Lolita, right? He also directed a movie called The Lion in Winter, which is basically like a family drama starring Eric O'Toole and who else was there? I think Timothy Dalton was there. I think Eric O'Toole,
Catherine Hepburn,
and yeah.
Timothy Dalton, Anthony Hopkins
in his first role. Yeah, he got an Oscar nomination. It's basically Succession, but in medieval England.
That was a great movie.
Succession in
Succession, really? Matlab fully familial Succession in medieval England. That's
okay.
Yeah, it's Sylvester Stallone's favorite movie, Lion in Winter, of all things.
Wow.
Interesting. Wow. What a nice digression.
You
said Anthony Harvey, right? I remember Lion in Winter. I remember how good, well edited that movie was.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah.
I think like Kubrick has a certain style. Like he lets his scenes play out as they are, and that pacing is kind of like obvious. It'll land well, and there's an inevitability to all of his cuts. I don't think he's never
going to shorten his pacing just because it needs.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. It's just that
he's not gonna wait for anyone.
I think in Lolita it did, like this time especially. There's this moment where Humbert is sitting in the lodging over, and that guy comes, Peter Quilty comes, and he's just like faced away from him, standing, and just keeps on blabbering. And I was just like, it's quite amusing, but I'm just like. It's going on for too long. Like I'm just like I think what I was reading was that they wanted to essentially create the obsession he has with Quilty equivalent to he has with Lolita, which again I didn't think came across to me. But
yeah, it didn't work.
I didn't think that came across. But Quilty does become a villain figure very, very much. So
yeah, I think.
I think that also kind of takes away from the overall impact of the movie. The fact that there is a quote-unquote definitive antagonist. I think the fact that he has a face, that fact that we recognize him as antagonist, I think it would have been more effective if he had just been in the background. Like
I think it's almost like the film is trying to recreate, which happens a lot in another Kubrick film, which you're going to move on to. And I didn't know I had that digression in that segue in me, but I will go to that by that. But essentially the repeat of the first half in the second half via the relationship of Lolita Mason and Quilty. Yeah. So you know it's like the Shelley Winters gets substituted out, and then James Mason's character becomes that character. Lolita
takes the place.
Exactly. So it's becoming another triangle essentially, but a much weaker triangle, in my opinion. Like, I think the first half cut triangle is much, much more.
No, that first triangle was extremely. The first triangle was extremely strong. Yeah, 100%. Because
now, I think it might be also like Quilty does not have the same sort of. Since you've already seen desperation, he's kind of imitating whatever Mason did.
You are
kind of seeing the same way. Like when he's trying to like get the when he's trying to get into
it's
the,
also yeah but the, it's also the, like wow I'm bringing a Spider-Man joke here it's wow. like it Yeah, it's like Venom being basically like an imitation of Spider-Man in a way, just being kind of stronger. So basically Spider-Man having to fight off against somebody who is equivalent to him.
Huh. It's a dark side thing.
It's
which
a dark
is
side
in the
version,
novel
basically.
Also. Yeah.
But again, it's like, but again, considering what the character is, Humbert's character is, I don't think he needed a dark side anyway.
Yes.
It's like,
but that's, I think, the whole key, you know, slightly the challenging thing of sympathizing slightly with, which is what happens in Clockwork also, right? Because it's this whole, he puts you in the very, very weird position in that film of...
I mean, I think, I feel like the Clockwork Orange is a lot more clearer. I think he's not...
Clockwork Orange, I don't think he's cared about sympathy at all.
I don't think he's sympathizing, but then, okay, so, okay, we'll talk about this, but...
Okay.
We'll talk about this because we'll segue directly to it, but...
I know, right, we'll be more, not... Okay, there's two more things I wanted to cover with Lolita. One was... Yep. One was why, okay, first, sympathy, I think, like, how much you're connecting with the character, or at least giving him a reason to, like, giving him an out. His out is that he's got, does he have that much of, like, a threat from Quilty that he has to,
I think it's
sort of
guilt also, no? It's like, it's almost like he knows that he's transgressed,
he's setting her up,
because that's why he can't protest to any institution, right? Because he knows that if they realize what he's done and what their relationship is, he's going to get absolutely, well, rightfully so, you know, persecuted. But
I
then
mean, persecution is something, again, we're Clockwork Orange. We're like,
it's a rationalization. It's the rationalization of perversion, which they can't take, right?
Yes.
Which is what is always been going on. Which this movie also kind of tries to do, but is also technically condemning that.
Yes.
Because he's like, through structuring the movie like a quote-unquote rom-com in a way, because that's what he's doing, right? So Kubrick is basically showing you the irony that, you know, this is so hunky-dory. If you take away the lens, it almost feels like a romantic comedy, except you know what is exactly happening and you know how messed up it is.
Yeah.
So,
But I like that he never threaded that line too much, because
he never did.
That's when you start to like lose people, think that, wait, are you actually, is this now a real thing? Sympathizing, is this ironic? I thought you were being ironic here. Now I'm feeling uncomfortable.
Very interesting, because this is something, just to make the, I know we're not going to Eyes Wide Shut, but this applies to Lolita also. But I think Kubrick said while talking about, because the weird thing is, Eyes Wide Shut is a constant in Kubrick's life, actually, because that novel, Traum novel, by Arthur Schnitzer, has been, like, he's wanted to adapt it since 1950s, and then he went to, maybe that's why people really care about Eyes Wide Shut also. Sorry, this is me projecting my thoughts on why people love the film. But I'm becoming Tom Cruise, which means I'm an idiot and not good looking, which, you know, that's a bad competition. But, No, I'm saying that, he said, basically, I have always been interested in doing a modern love story with backgrounds of Ivy League, Park Avenue and Greenwich Village, which happens in Stanley wrote much in the same mood and feeling as some of Arthur Schnitzer's work. Katie, charm, humor and excitement on the surface, concealing a fundamentally cynical and ironic sense of tragedy beneath the surface, which is basically Lolita down to a T. Essentially, it's kind of like getting straight at, I'm like, this is basically that, right? Isn't it exactly the same thing in both these films in some ways? So
this is even with this, I mean, this happens a lot with other directors also. This is like this,
but very few people I think manage to do irony as well as he does. I think he really knows how to do it well.
He knows how to balance it out. He doesn't know.
I mean,
how to...
he knows how to frame it. Like, you can't go through. The thing is that he doesn't want to lose. He knows the motives of each character really, really well.
He doesn't have to luxuriate on specific stuff for too long, right? He knows exactly.
He doesn't bother. Yeah. He doesn't have to. That when you're like, he knows his story to tell, so you don't have to like distract. I think like the main distraction for me, at least in Eyes Wide Shut, I'm just like, little digression, is
that's okay.
why do you like why does Tom Cruise have to go back and meet everyone?
Meet everyone.
Why does he have to do that?
Okay. Minding. That's a good question. We will hold on for when we discuss.
The Bachnaya Asino principle.
I don't think he said, okay, anyway, yeah. we'll get to this later, but let's go back to our first, the other segue, unless you have other thoughts. Lolita, I think we all like it to some degree. You found it especially a bit challenging on a rewatch, Hemant, right? Because of the runtime, right? I think you were saying.
Yes, runtime mostly. I think I still found it enjoyable. It's a very fun movie to watch.
It's a fun movie. No, I mean, it is fun. It is fun in that, considering the topic he's engaging with, the fact that it makes a movie so engaging and not portentous or not extremely emotionally complicated. But like, it is complicated, but he makes
it palatable. Done in a way which is tongue-in-cheek also at times. It's not taking itself super seriously.
I never found him to go to a place where he knows he's... I mean, you're not going to be able to make a good point. Like, for him, like, he doesn't fall flat on at least... I would say James Mason's ending is something that it actually... It works out in Kubrick's favor in that the tone of that seedy helplessness is not lost.
Yes.
Like, you can go through a whole movie thinking, oh, this is the same trick. Huh? You're not going to surprise me anymore. And it, in the end, you kind of get surprised with, like, how he doesn't really feel that... he didn't feel that he was kind of, like, making this whole Quilty thing happen. He will... At least he sees her in her normal, like, you know, life. That it makes it, like, a sick joke that he had to go through all that.
Yeah,
that she definitely moved on, but also it gives some, like, it gives him a way of, like, saying that, okay, this guy deserves to, like, not have that kind of ending. So to be able to, like, you know, if you don't have, you go through such a huge movie to make that character go through, like, that strenuous journey,
but that's a loser's journey,
rather than the one who is being the victim. So they're not victimizing him.
He's not a victim at all.
That was the danger of it all, is that you show it long enough that you victimize him.
Which is why maybe I was not thinking about that stupid producer, his co-producer.
The pedo producer, yes.
But yes, we will take a short... Well, I will take a short break. You guys continue talking about... A Clockwork Orange.
Oh,
this is basically for transitioning, I guess. But anyways.
Let's get it, boys!
I mean, we can set context of, like, when it released and what's like, I mean, Clockwork Orange released at a time when it's you've got movies which are pretty intense. It was 1971 is a good great year actually for movies.
I mean, it's the 70s anyway, right? It's like
The
70s are like
If you look back at, like, the movies of the time, you've got French Connection, Dirty Harry, Last Picture Show.
Yeah,
I would say that Last Picture Show has a lot of, at least editing wise, in common with Kubrick.
I mean, like, 70s means New Hollywood, right? So at this point, And it's not just for USA, right? In every country itself, I think that decade itself is like bringing in new blood and a new sort of energy because of the war that is happening. Like Vietnam War is almost towards the end and everything of that sort. Like there is a sense of nihilism throughout. And I think that is definitely being felt, especially considering I don't think I ever called Kubrick a sentimentalist, but I think Kubrick is very emotionally open, right? Because
I think he, I mean, he's very honest about like a
yeah.
lot of things that he covers. I've never seen any sort of jadedness or I mean, the irony doesn't come out of cynicism. I feel it comes out of empathy for what's going
Illegitimate
on.
empathy,
Yeah, and then all he wants to show is like what's the thing that's causing it the most. And for him, it's just the stress of the stress being put on everyone else because of the, I mean, I don't know, the slow kind of like egotistical minds of some men. Yeah,
Yes.
and so only it's always like boils down to like a few characters, and most of the time it's very for very dumb reasons. Many it's like either for jealousy or a power play or it's got yeah, that's a very general kind of like coding for Kubrick. But in like
Again, you
the
only get so
progression, yeah,
much.
in the, when
Yeah.
the progression he makes from 2001 to like to Clockwork. He kind of becomes more aware of like what can how can you really show it you how can you make someone like an anti I mean he is an anti-hero
Yes,
technically
yes.
he like well he, and he, if you
He
compare him to
essentially
okay I'll
breaks.
compare him directly to like straw dogs okay like
Okay,
Sam
okay.
okay,
Sam
came out in the
Peckinpah.
same year we've
Yeah.
got an
Dynamite movie
anti-hero
in terms of both its content and politics.
yeah
Dynamite movie in terms of both its
Dynamite, yeah.
content and politics, both, yeah. It is something. That movie
Yeah.
is something.
If you want to, if you get easily offended, never watch Straw Dogs, please.
That,
It is,
I
it's a
mean, that's a,
really.
I felt a little bit of an antithesis of like this kind of movie of where there you're actually kind of put in place of like you're kind of looking at the watching the crime and it kind of like glorifies the crime.
I can
Where,
totally understand that,
yeah,
yeah.
and here it actually it doesn't glory it makes the crime very so it numbs you with the crime. It kind of like over for him it's ultra violence. For him like exposure is the problem. Like
Yes.
it's almost like in the beginning when they're going to the theater and everything and. You kind of like get an idea of like I felt very similar to like 2001. I was like in the he's kind of mood. You're in it now. And now it's
Yeah.
gonna like for in 2001 it kind of gives you this like it's kind of like a riser. But here it's more of like a crescendo. It's like it's like the change between day and the life. You know, like from John Lennon's part to Paul McCartney's part. He's kind of like it's very
Wow.
atonic. Yeah, I really thought of it that way because I never felt like I was losing, I was getting lost in the scene. It
Sure.
was mostly just like you know that face you make when you're like just uncomfortable watching something with your parents. That is what I had alone. So,
Yeah.
I mean, once you have that like tone set, then you can kind of do anything you
Yeah.
want. Like, and that's why you wanted to tell the story in the perspective of this like. Kind of Malcolm McDowell's character of
Droogie, right?
Droogie.
Yeah.
I mean
What I
I love
like,
the names. I love the way they
yeah,
talk.
it's the
Like that's
mix
one of
of
the things.
what Russian and Cockney, right? Or something. I think.
Kind of, yes, kind of, I
I think
think.
that was the language that was in the book, which it's adapted from Anthony Burgess's
What I liked is
1962
he's
book.
essentially what I liked is he's essentially like he's essentially breaking the character down, which is why the glorification happens in the beginning. It's a rising
Yep.
action, and then he's breaking the character down to their barest essential through
Yep.
the punishment and through the corporal punishment, and then trying to bring them back up, only to show that the ultimate point, ultimate way out is returning back to square one.
Yes.
I think the fact that he ultimately returns to square one shows the apathy, because he's like, nothing matters. Because if you are breaking a guy down and then bringing it back up, it's the system which is the problem. The system has been perpetuating the cycle of violence throughout. And at the end of the day, whatever you do, however you go on, whatever version of the system you're enacting, the only way to live is again existing in the same sort of apathetic bubble you have been existing again and again, because humanity is doomed. Because, and that is what, that is entirely his reasoning in this full movie.
Yes, it is.
I mean, he kind of accepts it, really. He's accepting,
which is which is the only issue maybe I had this time. I was like, this is the same issue, which I know, Amartya, you don't like the movie, but weirdly enough, I thought about Alex Garland's Civil War while watching this time. Because because it has a similar point of view. It's like, you know, we are fucked. And I'm like, and you know, like, that's sort of, it's less with
No, but it's like, see, here's the thing. I'm going to bring up another recent movie, which I was talking with Dhruv just before we started recording. Like, Civil War says we are fucked. We have a question. Okay, you have anything substantial to say about that?
Yeah.
Or just, you know, you are dealing with it wallowing aesthetically and just wallowing in the misery and everything. Yeah. Agra says India is fucked. Okay, you have anything substantial to say about that rather than just wallowing in the misery and everything else? A Clockwork Orange says humanity is fucked, and the entire point of the character arc being a flat line is the overarching flat line.
It's not a flat line. It's like a, it's a clockwork orange, it's a circle. Whatever circle. Yeah,
okay,
yeah,
okay, it's a golem. It's a circle. Thing. Whatever it is. Yes. It's whatever it is. It's a circle. Yeah, but it's the overarching circle within which so many things are happening, within which we see an arc of a human being built up, then broken down, and then built up again, only to realize that we are back to the same circle again, because that's what humanity is. Humanity, at the end of the day, will only revert to their basis primal state. Yes. That is what this movie is trying to show.
What is the basis primal? It's very, you know, this time I was thinking about the implication of the film so much. Like earlier, I used, because I think the biggest change I've had is somehow realizing that I like The Shining more than A Clockwork Orange, which I think is shocking. Because I thought A Clockwork Orange was my third favorite Kubrick film, right? I thought it was not third. The top three is very hard to breach. I was like, the top three will not be breached for me. It's too hard. But I was like, because I thought this was like one of my favorites, and I watched it and I was like, but maybe The Shining does do bits of this better for me, which is weird to say, because it's similarly about violence essentially as a human condition. Like, again, as what you said, right? Like, it's part of the evolutionary cycle. Like, people, that's their tendency. And of course, it's extended to, because I think this film has points where it does almost tip over into becoming a little too misanthropic. Like, I think it's a little too, like, the gaze almost does become,
I think it's the anger also at the vicious cycle of it all, be it violence, be it governmental bureaucracy, be it all of it, even corporal or, you know, government sanctioned work of treatment at the end of the day is ultimately used for other ends. That is what he's trying to say.
I mean, like, conversion therapy.
It's conversion therapy, yes.
Absolutely. Yeah, conversion, like, I think it's the most the film comes down against is actually the prison system. My alternative title, sorry, I will do this for every film. Forced reform.
My hands shake as I write these lines.
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Can God forgive us for what we've done to this world?
Back to Clockwork Orange. So it's interesting that this is one of the most faithful adaptations I think Kubrick made from the novel that Burgess has written. I also
think this is sneakily very influential in its depiction of dystopian England. Especially if you think about, has anybody read Alan Moore's V for Vendetta?
If
it's comics, I've read it.
Alan Moore's V for Vendetta, I think, is very inspired from this.
I guess Watchmen is also
Watchmen is 100% like it's sure. it's taking its inspiration from British history, gunpowder plot and everything, but that nihilism overall, which Moore was an expert in at times, nihilism and irony. I won't be surprised if he was inspired heavily from Kubrick.
Yeah,
A Clockwork Orange, especially from its iconography, feels very much inspired. I think V for Vendetta feels very much inspired from A Clockwork Orange.
Yeah, I can see. I mean, I've seen the movie, so I'm speaking more from that POV. But
if you look at Clockwork Orange and like the style of, I mean, his production design, like how it just got better and better. Like, I think Clockwork Orange, by far, I think is the best one on set.
Have you seen the interior of the house? The interior of the house is very, very like...
It tells you the whole world.
It's swinging 60s.
I mean, not just swinging and sexist 60s, let's just say.
Fully.
I mean, that was like, I felt like if that is like the, I mean, I always like try to look at movies on like, you know, like a time capsule of like, like, this is what you think of the world, right? Like, so like I, and this was one of those movies of like, oh, this is so like, this is definitely of its time. This is, there is a clear kind of like commentary he wants to make on what England is like. Like he moved to England.
100%, right?
He
moved. From this time on. I think he's all in England. If I'm not wrong.
And this is his own production house. Like he's using his own production.
And Warner Brothers has sort of struck up a deal, and they are basically, you know, we are going to do everything with you. Essentially,
Warner Brothers. Back when they were actually a sensible studio.
With Zaslav, he'll go back in time, don't worry. When there's a time machine,
he will get the time machine, he will go back in time and he will try to
he's like, what do you want in your life? I want Max then he'll go ahead, then he'll go back, okay, good deal. He will, you know, like the scene, the eye opening scene, the conversion therapy scene.
Ads with
the Mantis.
He will be shown for Max Sky ads full on.
If you have ulcerative colitis, this is what you need, is there like an ad coming in on his face?
So in the 1970s England, England was ruled by Conservative Prime Minister Edward Heath, right?
Mm.
So Edward Heath's administration during that time was characterized by economy policy failures, a flawed victory, and an election defeat in 1974.
Mm.
Heath resisted the new right, cut
74th
taxes.
Would be too late though, no?
1970 to 74. So when he made Clockwork Orange, during that time, Heath was already in power. So
Burgess wrote it in 62. So it wasn't that far off also.
Heath resisted the new right, cut taxes, increased public expenditure and settled generously with the miners.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So this is the other thing about, there's lots of contestable things about Clockwork. I think there's this whole thing that what is this world? Is this like a full-on, like, you know, has the world become totally anarchic or has it become a totally fascist? Because I think it's like it's become like a communist, fallen communist state, and then it's going towards fascism.
I think it's interesting if you look at like from an aesthetic standpoint. I think Clockwork also reminded me because of its overtly highly sexualized imagery. I think it reminded me of, interestingly, The Velvet Underground.
The documentary by Todd Haynes, which is
Not just the documentary itself. Album and who was responsible for that group and that entire avant-garde.
Their aesthetic. They are very specific aesthetic.
Other
band had.
Exactly.
The album art was pretty good.
Velvet Underground ka Nico ka album art with that banana. Sure. That is iconic, that album art. But it's like, that overall aesthetic, I was especially reminded of that aesthetic in that milk bar. The milk bar aesthetic is very specific, that avant-garde.
I thought that was like a reuse of the ending of 2001.
That's a zoom out shot.
It
begins with his face and then the camera just zooms and pans, I think both. Like it's going, dollies back and zooms out both. And you kind of see him situated in that... bar.
Yeah, if you want to make the folk, if you want to make the focal plane stay constant and
and move back.
Yeah.
Then they didn't have, imagine this, he could have done this in Premiere Pro with crop.
He didn't have those.
He didn't have that.
But so I think that's a very common thing he does in a lot of his 70s work, at least Kubrick, which is the consist. He does both, like zoom in, zoom out, and sort of dolly back both dolly at the back, same time. Because there's a lot in Barry Lyndon also, if I'm not wrong.
I think Barry Lyndon's
is all zoom, just zoom.
It's all
zoom.
Is there no dolly? Okay.
No, no, Barry Lyndon is full zoom, right? It's entirely static shot and it's just zoom out.
Zooming out, zooming in.
Yeah, there was a whole point where he was wanted to make it a painting.
It's a 70s thing. A lot of filmmakers, like, it's almost like they discovered the zoom and then they were just like, you know, playing around with it.
I was going to make a bad joke with Michael Bay discovering the drone camera and now everybody's over.
But he's good with it though, right? His use of drone is good.
He's the only one.
Okay.
Yeah. I like the Kubrick is very good with technology, so he doesn't overdo it. I think that this whole movie has a nice, like, if you just look at the way they shot, like, I love all the three movies. I am like a mad person on, like, looking at how he does oneers, like, Spielberg stole the 1 minute oneer from him. Like, he completely lifted all of it. Fucking Lolita mein, there's like, there is literally one shot of him going into the room, coming into the room, her lying over here, and then you go from a triangle to, like, and then he goes.
He
creates shape with people's movements. It's amazing.
Yes. Yeah.
It's insane how he does it. This shit in Clockwork Orange, you have all diagonal shots.
Yes.
He doesn't do Dutch angle, but he does Dutch angle only when there is handheld stuff.
I don't think there's much Dutch angle in his work at all, actually. Like, it's always, but his cameras never, like,
his cameras never use those angles anyway, right? His cameras are always looking for coverage, like, coverage as much constricted space as possible. It's always like diagonal angle or something of that sort.
I think he frames them. Like, there's tension in the frame. You know, like how they. How if I, like, peep my
like,
hand
I remember,
out of the frame?
Like, I remember that shot in Clockwork in which he's lying in the bathtub, right? When he, in the second half, that sequence.
Yeah.
Even that sequence, I'm like, how he has framed
it's like
that
everything
shot.
Is mounting over him.
Parts of Clockwork, I think, are some of his most, going back to his more dynamic editing also. Like, there's this really terrific moment where it, like, firstly, it's that incredible fight sequence in the beginning between the two gangs, underscored by the thieving magpie's music, which is central to the whole film, actually.
Well, also, fun fact on that, that's a sampled machine. That's a sampled instrument. They didn't actually use the
really.
That's all sampled.
Okay.
Everything is sampled. In this whole, I can go on the album of this album. This whole movie, dude. This movie has an insane. For a movie that's so fucked up, it has a great, like, it has a really good score. Like,
but that's the whole high and low mix, no? I feel like it's the whole high. Yeah. It's the Beethoven being the supporting musical instrument to a Nazi
This is Baby Driver. This is Baby Driver for ultra violence.
For the 70s?
Driver for ultra violence and sexual deviance.
For them, Beethoven is like... Yeah, like, hooligans will think...
Even
will
you could even link Ansel Elgort to it, which would be...
Ansel Elgort, he's also an abusive fuck. Man, we have all, like, we have just referenced one by one, all references to abusive fucks. Like, first you have...
That first sequence, by the way, that first sequence is minimum, is a tad bit sloppy, but it also reminds me of West Side Story, if you want to connect it to Ansel Elgort, please go for it.
With the shadows, you know, nice, good one. Yeah, like, as Lolita and all that, 1954 it was, right? He was around when that director was there. Yeah.
Who?
Which one?
Or is this too late for him?
West Side Story. Robert Wise, West Side Story is 1968, I think.
61, so he was a contemporary.
61, he's a contemporary.
Okay.
Yeah. Wise was a fantastic director. Clockwork comes out when? 71, right? Wise makes Star Trek the motion picture in 74, I think. 73 or 74.
Wow, dude. This guy made Star Trek motion picture?
No. Star Trek the motion picture came out later. It was after Star Wars. So before that, he made Sound of Music.
Right after this, damn.
He's a Robert damn Weiss. Prolific. Yeah, Robert Weiss. Yeah. Damn prolific director, man.
Yeah.
He made a lot of movies. Anyway, my point being, it feels very much like that, especially that opening sequence.
Mildly sloppy.
Mildly sloppy, but reminds you of the West Side Story car fight sequence.
There's this one sequence when he's like dreaming about what gets him off, essentially, which is where you do the. Where he has like these, again, as you said, diagonal shots of the cross, like the Christ cross, I think, like the biblical feet. And then there's like, you know, it's almost like that Eisenstein cut sort of montage thing going on there. Because he doesn't do that much later on, because he doesn't do, you know, hyperkinetic editing and all that stuff.
But the first 40 minutes of
this is that hyper stylized, somewhat, you know, aggressive. Almost embodying a violent ultra violence and sort of that in place, because it's going to then puncture it through different techniques, mainly being the Ludovico technique, which is essentially Pavlov experiment, I feel, in many ways.
Yes.
Where you see something and you get socially conditioned and you basically,
I mean, his whole shtick with the second half was conditioning, like,
yes,
or
the pacing also becomes deliberate in the prison sequence when he's in the prison. The pacing is very deliberate. It also becomes
that's almost like the stationary point of the film, like the midpoint in that sense, and then the film goes and then does a loop.
It goes back to the same point, place, like you said.
Clockwise and anti-clockwise.
It's like Kubrick being. Yeah,
oh man, don't
Kubrick
remind me of Workout, dude. Oh my god, sorry, I go.
It's like Kubrick suddenly, due to the deliberate pacing, he's also using that, you know, famous like symmetrical coverage and all that stuff, which is very famous for, right? Even in Full Metal Jacket, he utilizes that in the first half.
I feel like his whole I've seen every single one of the, or at least whatever internet archives has, I've seen all the pictures that he has ever taken, where
that's the reason we were waiting for Hemant for all these episodes. We were basically planning according to
the obsession.
You're the obsession.
He has a quote, right, of like, hey, you like, do you have how long do you do pre-production? It was like, as long as there's time, I do pre-production. That's how he is with like all the pictures. That's how I want to look at him, at least. I don't know him. He's dead.
Yes.
I don't think
people who knew him that well, to be very honest with you.
Peter Sellers was very close to him, apparently, even, of course, his wife was, which we will get to. With Ice White Shirt, but yes,
we got to her before, and then in his pictures, he used to always frame people in spaces, like he doesn't like having too busy shots. I've never seen every shot is
exactly like, no busy shots.
Has like characters max, like three characters, because he likes shapes, and then he always shoots it very objectively. And he's got no, like, he doesn't care what that person is feeling in that moment. All he cares about is like, what kind of story can I tell based on just like their position in the frame and what they're doing. Most of the time, it's like someone is there's a very nice shot of him, of a kid on top of a fence. He's just looking up, and there's just the buildings there up there, and it has a very Dickensian kind of feel to it. He grew up in a very Dickensian New York. That's also one more thing,
and he's also very well to do, one of the, at that point I think his father was a doctor and everything, so I think it's the whole
Would have been like, you know, the Van Verbeek, you know, have you seen Van der Verbeek? There's one channel of one dude who is like, he takes only pictures with film, of course, in New York, and San Francisco also, and then he has a whole bag line from moment.com. I'm like, subscribe, please. Like, sponsor this podcast. There was one, yeah, so he would be that in his time. Like, yeah. That would have been him. He would be the fancy. But he had a nice, like, way of showing that kind of raw cynicism to whatever was around him. He never exploited any of the subjects. I never saw, like, any of the pictures didn't seem like too staged. They were kind of like, okay, you look here and you just stand there. I don't care about you, whatever you're doing. Maybe I can get it in frame, but I won't be able to like manipulate it into happening. That's something I see in Clockwork too. Like there's like so many things where it's just objective eye and it's got no emotion. I mean, it's got no sentimentality to the character. It has an emotional energy to it. That's mostly done by.
I would say that the way the drama works, it does, if anything, push you towards at least accepting Alex as he was. Let me just say that. Which is a very disturbing implication because I was in my head thinking, how bad can it be to take the free will of someone whose free will is that corrupt? You know, because that's basically a lot of the tension.
It's a question. It's the question which kind of sort of also begins the kernel of fascism in a way, right? Because all things evil are, you know, beset with good intentions anyway. So it's like, it begins as a way to combat crime.
Yes.
I think Spielberg kind of updates Kubrick's entire ethos in Minority Report. Clockwork Orange's ethos, Kubrick kind of tries to update it in Minority Report, though he tries to also make it a blockbuster, but the basic core concept is kind of same.
I was thinking more just on the lines of, because I think this is the most I've actually thought about, apart from The Shining, which we will get to in 2 months. I know I'm going to be very gushy about 2 months, which I'm going to be very gushy about, considering I've done a nice 180 on it. You know, like in this, I was just thinking about the implications of whatever happens, and just the film is so fable-like in the way it's symmetrical, like the narrative is so symmetrical in the way it also, like, you know, goes from, because essentially he gets exploited by everyone he exploited, which is the whole
basically
thing.
Golem.
Yes, Golem. but in this, so I was thinking, like, you know, every person is so cruel. Like, you know, even this propensity for people to just do the worst, like there is no, which is why the film feels like it comes down so hard on society more so than the individual. Like the institutions are corrupt, the individual
It is very much like a commentary on the prison complex, on overall family,
even the family scene is so uncomfortable. Like when they are like, and like, you know, forced to essentially abandon Alex, I was just like, yuck. Like, just in terms of, it looked yucked in terms of the production design, like deliberately. It's a bit too, like, you know, gaudily,
it's
colorful,
crayonish, crayon colored, pastel colored, gaudy,
yeah,
you know, aesthetics.
It reminds me of a bit of Antonioni, never mind, it reminds me of Zabriskie Point's production design, which released a year later or a year before. I forgot.
I don't think it came out before it, but
it has a similarly gaudy, like, it's the maybe hippie whatever thingy at that point in time.
It's pop art, yeah.
Yeah, it's pop art at that time. So I think it's getting at that more than anything else. But yeah, any other like particular thoughts on A Clockwork Orange? Just because I know we are strapped for time. That's
the
some,
six,
like, you know,
the quote-unquote threesome scored to the Beethoven.
That was pretty tastefully done, whatever that
means.
Yeah,
no, I that is a very striking imagery.
It is, yeah.
I mean,
it got sped up, right?
Yeah,
it was.
Just how the teenagers of today like it. Both in film and in
Dhruv sounding like a 90-year-old right now.
It's true though, like they want the whole sort of, like, you know, fast forward everything, then good. good for you. Kubrick did it in 1971. You can enjoy that pleasure.
He had to do it with his hand, with the crank.
Yes, exactly. Uske liye bhi difficulty tha.
No, but I do like how, actually, yeah, this is one thing I did really like about Clockwork. Like, there's this whole tension between the droogies also, right? It's this whole idea that even there's no system here which isn't corruptible. Even their group is that.
I'll bring in the maybe an idea of Eyes Wide Shut.
No, bring.
Eyes Wide Shut is that. Well, okay, there is a power play happening.
Yeah.
If that they wanted, I mean, what if there is a homoerotic kind of angle to it?
There might be. I mean, I didn't think of it, but I didn't think of it in this.
Usse sochne ke liye thoda energy chahiye na movie mein.
Oh, he's talking about in Clockwork Orange, not in
Eyes Wide Shut.
Hey, first off,
the slander has already begun.
Slander for Eyes Wide Shut. There is quite a bit of energy.
No, this is an energetic movie. Like, this movie is...
Clockwork Orange is energetic at the highest point.
This was probably his most...
The singing in the rain thing is absolutely horrifying.
Oh, yeah.
So,
that was awesome.
Yeah. But I do... Again, the revenge taken
is... And I was also happy as a musical hitter. Yeah!
Yeah, because you are you're one of the very few people who likes Babylon more than Singing in the Rain, which I think is
Babylon
a bit of...
Babylon is a fantastic movie. What are you talking
more than
about?
Singing, they actually even have a shot of Singing in the Rain.
I know.
They have a shot of Avatar in it, which is very disappointing to me, but still.
Yes.
Any other thoughts on Clockwork Orange before we move on to Eyes Wide?
We did not talk about that harrowing sequence of how he kills the woman by breaking into her house.
I think because we both talked about it before we started the podcast.
We were like, okay, we know this is messed up. There is,
What I was terrified is how he uses the handle camera, because imagine that sequence and imagine the angle he's using the camera, and I'm like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
I think for him, this is a more objective thought on this is him kind of stating that, if you had any doubts of not liking this guy, you're not supposed to like
this guy. Yeah, you're not supposed to like this guy. Yeah.
I think at the first 45 minutes are pushing you to absolutely, be repulsed, hate, whatever. And then after that, it's like, oh, wait, but everyone around him is literally the same thing. Then what do you say? Then is it his fault? I feel to me, it's that question. And it's his fault.
It turns into the absurd at that point because of after the prison sequence and how they kind of because of their own agendas, people trying to push this method.
I mean, the state sanctioned thing, because in the end, it becomes the fact that he does become his own person, but now he's in a worse position because it's almost state sanctioned for him to become this person.
Yeah, to be a horrible person. Yeah. And also, it is almost he had a moment of my Führer with his hand, okay? The situation of
the fact that
happening to him in the whole movie.
I think the fact that the state is ultimately going to sanction him was proven even in that sequence where he meets one of the droogs who has become a police officer.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm like,
that was awesome. And him getting assaulted by
if you can't break them, co-opt them. Isn't that the entire point of a government anyway? If you can't break a dissident, try to co-opt them. And it's like, okay. Again.
But it's also one of those films which really doesn't come across well to the radicalist leftists also. It's very critical of them also. Even that old dude who's actually, Burgess, I was reading, Burgess actually based the novel on his wife getting attacked by four American vets. They had come back and they had sort of attacked and robbed, or I think even raped his wife. And then he wrote the novel as a response, and that's why the film actually, the one place where the film deviates massively from the novel is the ending, because in the end of the novel the last chapter was, weirdly enough, this is the first time this has happened, where the Americans did the better thing of not having a neatly tied up narrative thingy, essentially, where the Anthony Burgess in general wanted the film to end on him automatically becoming a moral citizen, Alex. It's like he becomes, as he grows up, he automatically gains a moral conscience. Whereas the American people were like the publisher was like, no, not that nonsense, you know, and which would be something.
You mean to say that Americans actually had a brain for once?
We're doing four episodes on an American, but yes. But
Kubrick is also, quote unquote, you know, an Anglophile more than anything else.
That is true. Yeah. But but the whole idea is that Kubrick would have definitely not taken that ending also, I would think. Like, it just doesn't fit.
Kubrick, no, because Kubrick...
this movie if it wasn't for...
Yeah,
Kubrick
doesn't believe in automatically gaining a moral conscience. Wo sab hota nahi hai. Clockwork Orange to is specifically like, however many experiences you gain, humanity will remain the same.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
or it will become whatever. Yeah, like you'll find institutions.
Or institutions will actually ensure that humanity will remain the same, co-opted under specific power. That's what he's trying to say. And whether you agree with him or not, you know for a fact that it is made in a very specific time with a very specific thought process, with very specific anger.
Yes,
you know?
Absolutely.
I mean, that whole singing in the rain sequence could have happened with cops. I mean, like, that was the whole point. Yeah. For him, it is that he doesn't care, like, who does what. In the end of the day, the status quo is going to be someone with this much, like, tendency for violence is going to have their way with it. They'll find a way to exercise.
They will find a way to,
It's called sublimation, right, for a reason. Like, is that, like, you will just change form on an extreme way. All their violent actions kind of came from, I mean, you don't even have to understand where it came from. It's just the state it is in
it
right
now.
It just
exists.
Yeah, it's almost not willing. There are some things, like, I think the whole point of the movie was that, like, there are some things that can't be given empathy. And how much ever you try, it's only going to make it worse for you. It's not going to be made worse for the one helping that person is going to be in more danger than the person themselves.
Mm.
For him, like the like to make their, I think, like, if you want to give a nice, like, neat little bow to it, he would have made if the novel was supposed to go that way. The only way that would happen is that if society itself has become way worse than his own actions.
Moral conscience becomes relative compared to societal downfall.
And this is what he's trying to allude to, but I don't think it would have gotten, I mean, if I don't think a movie about him becoming...
No, it's not about the reform. It is about the attempt
about
at
it
reform.
Yeah, it's definitely not about
failed
the reform
attempt. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Talking about things not working, I think it gives us a good opportunity to move on to a film which I think some of us think doesn't work. Some of us think works to a point, and some of us thinks works fully. This is Eyes Wide Shut.
What then? Look. Women don't. They basically just don't think like that.
Millions of years of evolution. Right? Right? Men have to stick it in every place they can, but for women, it is just about security and commitment. Whatever the fuck else.
A little oversimplified, Alice, but yes, something like that.
If you men only knew.
Kubrick's last film, not the last film we'll be discussing on the Kubrick whole, you know, are all four parts, but this is, for this episode, the last film we're going to discuss. Released in 1999, stars the charisma vacuum called Tom Cruise. I'm sorry, I love him in the Mission Impossible films, but he's really he's forced to play actually a person who is kind of a
straight man,
a boring man. Let's just
He's also kind of like a sexual vacuum. Like, at no point do the audience or even the view or even, you know, people, I can't buy anybody being attracted to him. That is a bigger problem. That is a way bigger problem.
Do you I'll ask you this after I introduce the film. Stars him and his then wife, Nicole Kidman, who's I think steals the film for how much ever time she's in. It's based on
Trump. Way better than him and acting.
That also is.
That is also very true. That is very true.
Yes. Yeah, it's based on Trom novel, the Arthur Schnitzler novel, which was released in 1926. The novel was, and I am not sure, and it's
you
not.
You know, I can
by...
understand. You know, I can understand why Kubrick is apathetic towards humanity. 1926 mein ek marriage ke baare mein novel aaya, which is basically talking about the same thing, and he exploring that in 1999, 70 years later.
Yeah, but things never change, Amartya. That's
yeah,
a normal
exactly.
thing. Yeah.
Human I mean, I've been having this, talking about marriage, I've been having this conversation with my wife about like, what are human attractions? What is going on?
What an auspicious day to encourage
what an
this discussion.
Day,
also, right? for anyone who doesn't, today, I mean, we can wish Hemant now, I think, because this is the moment to wish him happy anniversary. This is the movie to
this
you're
is
gonna
the
watch
movie
this
to talk
right
about. Yeah
tonight
the better
yeah.
one of the
you're
better
watch
movies
this movie
to have
tonight
talk.
Again
yeah.
right
oh, yeah, yeah. This movie
either like this or Blue Valentine you pick either this or Blue Valentine you pick
actually Blue Valentine is kind of tame in front of this honestly with the yes. I like the intensity of like how horribly they hate each other in the end like more than Blue Valentine actually.
But they decide to stick it out together, which is the other thing, which we will talk about in Eyes Wide Shut.
He's succession-esque. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's not just written by Kubrick. It's written by Frederick Raphael. Again, I watched this movie and read about this a while back. So I know there's a bunch of other writers who are also involved, but not credited in the screenplay of it. It's shot by Larry Smith, edited by Nigel Galt. And again, all this is... Actually, one of the reasons why Eyes Wide Shut always remains a curiosity is because Kubrick infamously, I think, passed away before it was completely edited, before it was completely marketed, things which he was always super involved in also. So I think there's always a suspicion that, you know, who has the final cut on the film? Does Kubrick have it or not? Apparently, he does. He submitted the final cut to Warner Brothers 4 days before he passed away. So you know, there's all that speculation behind it. The production went on for ages. I think it took what 3-4 years to get completed. It negatively affected the couple's marriage. It also stars Sidney Pollack as Victor Ziegler. It stars TARS director Todd Field as Nick Nightingale. I think that's one of his few roles that he's done. But the film itself is
Doesn't it also star that guy? Arre, what is the name of that guy? Arre, who is the proprietor of the Rainbow Room?
I forgot the guy's name, the character's name, but I don't know the actor. I've forgotten the actor's name also. Sorry.
Yeah, he's a working actor. He's a very famous actor. He has looked
into it. Until then, I will say my alternative title, which was Dirty Christmas, because I just watched. You know,
wow.
I think very suitable. I think.
Christmas is more likely about dirty. So it's not a slow Christmas.
But
yeah.
It is supposed to be like it's supposed to be about dirty thoughts and dirty desires, I suppose, in many ways.
Okay. Did you have dirty thoughts when the scene was going too long? When he was walking, man.
No. But it's supposed to be his psychological breakdown after hearing the fact that his wife can have dirty thoughts apart from him. Itself, right? That's the whole.
Also,
crux.
It's about him actually in another movie. Say, and when you.
No. It is. No.
I said the naval officer is you. It's in you in uniform.
I think there's a lot of. I think there's value to the film. I mean, I know, like, but I do also agree with Amartya that I do find it a little tiresome. Okay. I think he finds it not a little, but quite tiresome. But
I think I termed it as after hours, ka slower version.
Yeah, that's true. The Martin Scorsese, which I've never seen actually, which I've heard is great.
Whoa.
Right? So, yeah.
You'll be very surprised and pleasantly surprised. I wouldn't say that it's a bad. Yeah,
I thought it's like not... supposed to be very wacky and comedic, right? Or no?
It is. Yeah, that's like Scorsese's comedy coming out. Like,
interesting.
I felt like that was a very good like a pairing with Goodfellas. Like,
Oh,
right. Okay, I saw it with Goodfellas, and I found them to be very like similar in terms of just comedy.
Interesting. But this Eyes Wide Shut is not a comedy. Clearly not a comedy.
No, I think it is. No, I think he feels it is.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I think he feels it is.
Okay. Fine. I would say this is the least comedic out of the three films which we are discussing, and definitely not as comedic as some of his actual comedies, which are like Doctor Strangelove. But anyways, the film is about, this is the plot I'm borrowing, not, you've already heard my amazing title. So after Dr. Bill Harford's wife, Alice, admits to having sexual fantasies about a man she met, Bill becomes obsessed with having a sexual encounter. He discovers an underground sexual group and attends one of their meetings and quickly discovers that he is in over his head. Very apt, I think, and that is what exactly what the movie is about. It is also a 160-minute running. It also has a 160-minute runtime, which I think is a big detriment.
Out of which the majority of the minutes is basically following Tom Cruise as he walks across a London-rendered New York.
London-rendered New York, yes. Which most of his Kubrick's films after after 64 was, I think, because I think so. Anyways, I think we shall begin with Amartya, because I think he'll be briefer.
I am going to be brief anyway. It's like, see, the funniest thing about this whole movie, immediately after watching the movie, I messaged to the group, the funniest thing about this movie is the fact that Tom Cruise is a doctor. I can't for the life of me believe that he has the intelligence to be a doctor. But again, having said that, if he's supposed to be stupid, because almost all men in Kubrick's movies are.
Yeah.
So if he's supposed to be a Kubrickian protagonist who is a stupid a-hole,
I would say stupid and ignorant, because ignorance is something clueless. He gets at.
I think he's clueless.
I think he does it for a good reason. I think he wants it, like, he's like, that's the audience.
And it's also like Kubrick's attempts at showing how wealth and privilege hides you from the reality of the world, which further increases your naivete.
Yeah.
I'm saying this because all of this is inferred within the first 10 minutes. After that, I don't find anything new that Kubrick has to say, which is a big problem for me, because if this movie is supposed to be his comeuppance against the rich, his commentary against, you know, imbalance of wealth and disparity of wealth and how wealthy people utilize their riches to obscenity. Maybe this is just me, you know, having, you know, seen so many stuff. And again, this don't think is a Kubrickian issue. But I also believe that when the movie came out, I think this criticism might have been afforded to him again.
Yeah.
Which is the fact that we have seen movies, you know, quote unquote, eat the rich even during the 80s and during the 90s. Okay. Maybe not as overt, but there were movies like this.
I don't see it as a eat the rich narrative at all, actually.
I'm not even saying that even if it is eat the rich. I'm just saying that even if it was a satire against the rich, like looking at, oh, look what the rich are doing. Oh, look at how obscene it is.
It's a little bit of that, I think.
I don't think it's a little bit. I think that's the entire point of it.
For me, the point is very simple, actually. And for me, the problem is that the point is expressed very clearly in one scene. And I feel the film then has to go through the entire motion again and again to prove that, which I understand that's a lot of his films in any case. It's just that I find Cruise... his character, I won't blame the performance because I think it's more character.
Oh, I will.
Okay.
I will.
I don't think his performance is bad, actually. I think he's good. He's doing what Kubrick has told him to do.
I have seen good Tom Cruise performances, okay?
He's doing blank slate, somewhat bemused, I feel, which I think is what the directive is, because
he has a very crazy tinged laugh, okay? His laugh is very unique.
Yes, that's when he's in the party with the two girls who want to have a threesome with him, right?
Yeah, you can't have that crazy tinged laugh over what is essentially a blank slate.
But does he ever do that later on in the film? I'm trying to think.
Yeah, but when he's trying to quote unquote, I don't think even that is seduction, right? When he's trying to actually go and talk with Mandy's friend in the apartment.
I have genuinely noted down the six people he goes to. Okay, so because I was like, I will make sure to talk about this film in detail because I know I'm going to be on the more negative side of it. Anyways, yeah.
No, because Mandy's friend, the person who he goes to meet, right?
Yes.
Who finally tells him that Mandy had AIDS or whatever. Like she was HIV positive.
Yes,
so there was a very clear...
Domino, sorry.
Was a very clear sexual attraction
between Domino and him, I think. Right? Yeah.
Between the two of them. But even then, like... sexual attraction matlab wo nahi ki you put on that crazy laughter.
Okay, fair enough. I get what you mean. I know what
so
face you're referring
that,
to.
Are you
also
saying that Tom Cruise does not have Riz?
In this movie, no. He had Riz in risky business.
But
he had in risky business.
Do you think, and I would think, and this is what I was thinking this time, is that a accomplishment on Kubrick's part to make who was considered at that point in time one of the sexiest actors alive and
maybe,
probably still is,
maybe,
make him this uncharismatic and slightly doofishes? Or I don't know, I've messed up that word.
But if completely resorting him to an uncharismatic buffoon, if that means completely sidelining and zero-summing his entire acting prowess, zero-summing his acting prowess, that's a problem.
No, I get it. I understand it. And
I think he was really stretching it with Tom Cruise. I think I can admit to that. He was really stretching acting.
Who do you think would have probably been better at this part? Like
at the time?
Maybe now also you can just say
James.
No, the 90s, right? Who?
I would say someone like George Clooney might actually be decent.
I think Clooney might have been very good.
Clooney would have been nice. Yeah. I mean, if you want like really pretty boy to like
Pitt,
fall from grace.
Brad Pitt
is... Yeah. I can't buy Pitt as... No,
like
I can.
I
Clooney
can
is
buy
more
Pitt.
I can picture
is,
him now, actually.
This is 99, right? You can either put Pitt or Clooney. Pitt is
I would find,
Fight Club Pitt.
I would still
Pitt
find
Fight
it
Club
hard
Pitt,
to buy,
right?
buy Pitt as a doctor, though. You know, Clooney I can buy as a doctor.
Of course, Clooney you can buy as a doctor. He debuted
in
ER.
He was
a
doctor.
He debuted in ER.
That would have been an obvious casting.
Yeah, that would have been obvious casting.
Yeah, Clooney would be good, actually. Yeah.
I would actually think that, I mean, you can put like, you can put in a profession against any, you can't.
Or if you want, or if you want an actor, good looking enough actor to be a tad bit buffoonish in that regard, though I don't know whether Battlefield Earth came out that year, but
Travolta.
Yeah.
Travolta.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Interesting.
Same religion hi hai dono ka, dono were Scientology, same religion hi hai dono ka, so it's...
That way then Paul Thomas Anderson should have casted Tom Cruise in The Master also, right? And John Travolta as this master and the disciple, essentially.
He did not want to cast actual Scientologists, he was making a movie against Scientology.
But I'm laughing only because that movie is basically has, I think, two of the best performances of the past whatever, how many ever years, because I think those two lead performances and that are like spectacular.
Yes.
So,
yeah.
Philip Seymour Hoffman. No, but he's not as like he's too schlubby to be.
He
in that
is.
Role.
Yeah.
You shut
but,
your
I mean,
mouth.
You
he was a handsome dude. You
no,
shut
I'm saying he's
mouth.
Too schlubby for. The, he's not a Tom Cruise like doctor. Like I know he's. I love Philip Seymour Hoffman, but I won't imagine him in this role.
Yeah, I wouldn't have minded like Hoffman doing something like
this. I've seen
time,
him in
you know,
Synecdoche, New York. I think he's good at playing Charlie Kaufman enough. So I think it's okay.
He's really good at Charlie.
And as a dumb, arrogant rich man, I think Hoffman is good because he played the same character in Talented Mr. Ripley. He was in Talented. Yeah. So
interesting.
He could have done that.
If you want a really like towering person who you want to like really bring down to size, I think Daniel Day-Lewis would have been great because he would have been
that's
like,
true. Imagine Daniel Day-Lewis and Kubrick
Daniel
together. He wouldn't have finished the movie.
Yeah.
Probably.
Oh, imagine like Phantom Thread in the middle there, that whole like fashion sequence show suddenly turns into an orgy.
So as you have mentioned, we unfortunately have had movies, which I think I've watched, which I will always reference when watching Eyes Wide Shut now, because I think Phantom Thread is like the sexy version of this, or like a genuinely romantic version of something like
this.
Yeah,
it is a genuinely romantic version.
Or like, oh, perverted, but in a sort of playful way. This,
but
I think,
again,
is a bit like, you know, you're pushing them,
it's
him into
cold.
The ground.
No, I genuinely, like, Kubrick is cold is one of the most boringest criticism you can afford to the
of
guy.
Course.
Kubrick
yeah.
is Kubrick is detached and cold. This is the one time where he's very detached and very cold. Like,
I would say the film comes to life when Nicole Kidman's on the screen. And
yes.
I would say the film comes to life in the scenes she has with even the doctor, because I think that whole waltz they have in their place, I think is quite, you know, so to me, it's like very, like, that's what I said, right? It's very simple to me. That one sequence between Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman that happens, that's supposed to be the incident that then sends him into his...
That should have been the climax. That should have been the climax.
That's the setup,
I
though.
Thought, yeah, that is the setup. I think their setup should have not happened in a... I think maybe a space was an issue. The
it's
energy
also
of...
too. It's also too... I feel it's too impactful as a setup. It's one of those things where, you know... You
yeah,
have
where
a,
the build-up is so high, where the set the build-up
where
is
you
so
get,
high that the
yeah,
payoff
then
is...
nothing
really,
matches.
Yeah, yeah.
Then
yeah.
it's like it's... Because you're going to essentially one place failing... Second place failing, third place failing, fourth place failing.
Yeah, it's like when you learn that Tom Cruise's character, like his friend had recognized him in that orgy and everything, and he knew all that. I listened to that, I'm like, oh, okay. So, that is my literal reaction.
Yes.
So,
and then he lectures him about like stuff, like Sidney Pollack does when he takes him to, and he tells him we shouldn't be... fighting against the power who they know everything. And I'm like,
they know everything. I'm like, this is rich people. We are rich people. Nothing will happen to us. And I'm like,
and then he just leaves.
We know. My reaction is, we know.
No, and then he just leaves the place. I'm like, okay. Like, so, like, you know, like to me, it's a bit like that. It's like, I get it, but like,
I don't.
What do I get,
I get
after
I
getting it?
Yes.
You know, it is a big thing. Because I think the film is essentially about, you know, positioning itself against something like... Because the main thing with Cruise's character is he's like, he knows his wife. He's certain who his wife is. He's certain who women are.
Yeah, which, is
know,
the
that's whole thing.
Which is the cluelessest thing I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Exactly. So he says it and he's very confident about it. And I'm like, well, the film clearly establishes in that very scene with Nicole Kidman... that the whole film is going to knock back against it, right? Because the whole film is essentially just doing that. Because it's like, you know, he's not. He's trying to prove that he is, but he's not. And I'm like, I get it. And then the film tells me what it is. And I'm like, I got it. And then it tells me again what it is. And I'm like, yes. You know, it's like, I get it. I get
and also,
it.
And like, also, I think, of course, the Tom Cruise casting is a very... but the disengaging thing for me overall to enjoy the movie, that is one. It's also the fact that I genuinely wasn't interested in the odyssey that Tom Cruise's character is going through once the inciting incident occurred. His night
really like
sojourn.
I really like the
sojourn.
Flashbacks, whatever thing he, like whatever flashes of imagery he has of them having, like him with Nicole Kidman having sex with the...
Those are not flashbacks, those are imaginations.
Images which are like...
He's imagining her having sex with the sailor because she told that she has sexual fantasy. So he's imagining those sexual fantasy.
Yeah.
But the thing about that is that I never cared for the nighttime sojourn he is doing. If I wanted a night... Which is why I said that it's like a reduced, toned down, sped down version of After Hours, because movies like After Hours, they are... Their entire point is that one night is such a wacky one night that it is going to change everything about that life.
Yeah.
Like, that one night needs to be extremely impactful.
Mm.
a much more, you know, worse version of After Hours could be the Hangover movies in a way, because the Hangover movie, like Todd Phillips' Hangover movies, and the main is
Another Scorsese reference.
Again, whatever we might may think about the Hangover movies, I like the first part. I don't like any of the sequels. But whatever you mean to say, it's the entire conceit of that one night being an eventful one night means that it has to be eventful.
And this is, I think, taking that and being like, it is uneventful. That is the point. Like, you know, it's like we'll put him in these situations where there's a sexual encounter, there's another sexual encounter, there's another sexual encounter. But in actuality, I think, you know, the interesting thing about the film is I think, firstly, I think it works as much as a dreamscape, right? Because it's like him almost thinking like, this is what he's going through. And I think he's trying to position himself as this very honorable man.
Altruistic, honorable man.
Yeah, where he's like, you know, rejecting all these advances and he's like pious even after all this stuff. But he realizes that the desire, like by the end, of course, he realizes, but we've realized already because Nicole Kidman has told us in the 40th minute that of this 2 hour 40 minute film, that, you know, don't be so confident about this thing, you know, whatever. You are not, you can have these fantasies. That's, and I've noted down the bit of dialogue that guy says to Nicole Kidman at the party, and I've written down the time also. It's 9 minutes 45 seconds. He says, "Don't you think one of the charms of marriage is that it makes deception a necessity for both parties?" Yes, it is. That's the answer.
You said that in 9 minutes.
No, that's the question he asked, to be fair.
Yeah, but you are answering that in 9 minutes.
No, I mean, he asks it, but she answers it on the 35th minute. But yes.
Yes, Joby, you answered it within the first half an hour. And then you are essentially trying to reinforce that statement multiple times through uninteresting ways. But
not like any of the interactions he has with the people later in the nocturnal fan? Like the first one,
the rainbow room sequence is pretty fun because it's so wacky.
Japanese,
wacky. It's the closest it comes to being extremely wacky.
Weirdly enough, that's taken from a Nabokov novel, not from Tom novel. It's from another Nabokov novel. But yeah, anyways, yeah.
Wacky. I think I liked how the orgy, how the mansion itself was framed, you know, how the music is playing, how the camera.
Isn't there some
moving.
Indian instrumentation going on there, right?
Arabic.
Indian, huh?
Very exotic.
Eastern, I suppose, huh?
Very exotic.
Which fits within the context of
whatever
the film
they are
is
trying to
for.
Do. But again, amidst all that, especially after the orgy is done and everything, then after. Trying to investigate, being the clueless buffoon he is, him trying to investigate what is going on, I was completely checked out.
Oh,
I was like, okay.
So post the orgy also, there's a bunch of movie left, right? Because it's like...
Yeah, one hour.
1 hour, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because then Nick Nightingale character goes missing, then there's...
Yes. Alan Cumming has a role
there's a homoerotic thing, right? With the whole lobbyist, I think, where Nick Nightingale is staying. He makes advances at Tom. So basically, everyone is making advances at Tom Cruise because it's also, a projection of his whole thing. But everyone seems to be making advances at him, but he's either finding coincidences or ways to reject them or finding ways in which he becomes the nice guy.
I think in a way, if this entire layout of the movie was supposed to be, oh my god, look, it's such a big fat joke.
Yeah.
It needed to be funny.
Yeah.
It wasn't funny.
I think that's the big problem, I think, for me. It's like, it's not a funny film. Like, to me, this is very much a, you know, you are trudging through the night.
It's like, it's too serious. It's trying to be a dissection of a relationship.
Yeah.
But it's also trying to be, you know, a comedy about a man figuring out that no, he doesn't know anything about women.
Yeah.
And I'm like, you can't reconcile the two of them, right?
Mm-hmm.
At least you can't reconcile the two of them without one of them having a definite tone completely separate from the other.
Yeah. And I also think just the movie forgets Nicole. I'm like, just bring her in. Like, I think she just, like, you know, when she's on the screen, she's like doing her thing and she's a little more lively and she's like expressing stuff and everything. And I'm like, much better. Like, you know, like I feel like at least there's some energy in the film then. I like the title. I like the opening, whatever, hour quite a bit, because I think there's where all the meat is. And then after that, it just, for me, it's basically the orgy sequence is happening. And I'm like, it's already going on for too long. I'm like, you know, I'm like, this.
Again,
spent,
I
like,
told you, no, it's detached. It's, which in case of the orgy scene, I understand the detachment. I actually appreciate the detachment.
Yes.
It's like, he's looking at it through the lens of somebody like, you know what he's looking at? He's looking at it through the lens of the narrator looking at Barry Lyndon. That's what he's doing. That's what he's doing, which is fine. It's a good choice to make. But again, it needed to be both.
Oh, once they're asking for wishes. She's like, "Where are my wishes?"
Oh, happy anniversary!
Happy anniversary!
Just,
happy anniversary!
Just talking about a movie in which
we are just talking about a movie about the dissolution of marriage. What can we say?
I made her watch it. She is in your camp.
For a wedding anniversary. Like,
oh, wow.
Just how bad things could get. Like,
again, so my choice was my choice was this or Blue Valentine. My choice was this or Blue Valentine. Which one are you both?
Valentine at least was sad, but you could look at Ryan Gosling and feel better.
Ryan
Gosling would have been better than Tom Cruise in this.
Yeah,
Ryan Gosling would have been better. Yeah.
Yeah, he's done those silent roles a lot, though.
Scientology.
Mr. Scientology.
The entire movie has an undertone to it, if you think about it.
That is true.
I think Kubrick met Tom Cruise and he was like, "This I have to show this weirdo to the world."
And he wrote live observation mein
on their marriage. on you, Nicole Kidman.
You know what you know the points you're saying. I won't be surprised if he actually did that.
Yeah, he might have done that. Just
he might have actually done that.
Hope no one comes after us for this. Okay.
No, because Hemant will defend it now. I think
I have to defend it. I like the movie.
No, but we've blabbered on about it.
We bashed the movie quite a bit. So.
Yeah, I was trying to be reasonable, but okay. No, but even the encapsulation of what all we said is that it makes its point very clearly, and then I think Amartya especially, I think is getting, and I think I agree. For me, it's like the orgy sequence happens, and I'm like, oh, enough already.
Yeah.
Like, to me, it's like
the point has been made again and again. That's the problem.
No, for me, it's just like you can make movies, of course, which make the point again and again. It's just that in this, it's you lose. At least I lose interest. I'm just like, I get it. Like, I got
it's
the point.
It's the law of diminishing returns, more and more.
Yeah.
And also, at the end of the day, I boiled it down to a very simple statement. It's just not funny.
Which I didn't even think I was going to look for. To be very honest,
I wasn't going to look for either, but I felt like you're clearly going to mock. You're clearly going for mocking, somewhat at least.
Huh.
At no point am I supposed to feel sympathy for this guy. At least I didn't feel
I don't
sympathy
think
for this
we are.
Guy.
I think
all.
If anything, we are supposed to feel for Nicole Kidman's character,
yes.
Right? Because I think the film is taking her side more than anyone else's.
Yes.
I mean, they're telling. I mean, they're kind of. It's not like a side they're trying to play. I think it's that we know the objective truth is that that Nicole Kidman does not want him to stay the same kind of like, you know, his thinking has to be expanded a bit.
Yeah, it's
and
against that, certainty, like, right? Against certainty, huh?
Mm-hmm. Or, or helplessness, like
yes,
because she feels helpless in terms of like. I mean, what can I do with that? You're insecure. Like, because of his insecurity.
Cue every woman, woman who ever said that to a man. What can I do?
Because I've written this exactly thing, like, where she's like, Bill says women don't, they basically just don't think like that in terms of, you know, Because she says, do you realize that what you're saying is that the only reason you wouldn't fuck those two models is out of consideration for me, not because you wouldn't really want to. And then it's like, when Bill says women don't, they basically just don't think like that. And then she's like, you are very, very sure of yourself, aren't you? And then she starts telling him the story, I think. Yeah. And yeah, so I think that's the whole, but I think it, like, the interesting part about the conclusion to me is there, though. Like, I think it's interesting that I think this is a key thing where she says that, and yet at the same time, you were dearer to me than ever. Like, the whole jealousy making them closer to each other, which is a very,
I think those are the moments, those are the moments of emotional poignancy that Kubrick is going for. The fact that marriage is hard, the fact that marriage between two humans also has to take into account human beings as individuals, the fact that they are attracted to each other, but at the end of the day, there is a choice they make.
Yes.
Every single time.
Yeah, it's so, the whole thing that they survived, right? That's the whole thing at the end of the movie. They survived. That's the big thing, not anything else.
I mean, for them, it was, I thought that it was like, I thought it'll end in a more like gotcha kind of horror way where like the problem is still there, but it's like, I'm gonna compare this to the very shitty horror movie, like Three, you know, in this Three, when they get on the bus and they find out that she's still the ghost.
I don't think that would have worked well. You basically think the film could end at like the shot of the masks next to her in bed.
Yes, because of her like
there's a lot of masks in this. Huh?
There are fantastic images though. The fact image of her sleeping with the mask on the pillow beside her, fantastic image.
Lots of cold blues, cold Kubrickian blues.
Oh my god. I've been like having this whole thing of watching just blue movies. There's this, and then there's not blue movies.
Confessions of a Married Man.
On the day of his anniversary.
Okay? I don't need it. I have a female girlfriend, okay? Like I'm not an incel. Oh, okay. I don't know what.
I don't know where that went, but okay.
I don't know who talks like that, the coldness of the movie really comes across until you get to when he's insecure. I feel like the movie gets more pretty when he's insecure, like in the party, like when he's like kind of like
the party looks terrific, huh? Like the colors, it's so golden, like good golden, not gaudy golden.
I kept trying to figure out while the movie was going and speaking out loud to my wife that I think there's at least maybe a whole ray of lights, and then they have like a whole brute on here. I'm pretty sure. Wait, dude, watch the fucking scene.
This is why you like it, because you were like, you know, engaging with the technique while I'm kidding, but I'm wondering why.
Like, how did they do that? That was my whole thing. I think I was less like intrigued by the to me it's a very linear narrative, really. It's like an aesthetic that he chose,
I think a lot of people really do like it. Like I think they compare it a lot to like not a fever dream, because fever dream means it's exciting, like a woozy dream, let's just say that. And I also said that it's to me, it's basically a David Lynch film without the melodrama, which is a big problem, because a David Lynch film has emotion actually pouring out of it the most. So which whatever you want to make of it, you can. But I would say watch a David Lynch film, because I think he does surreal better.
Watch Twin Peaks, for heavens.
I would say watch, if you want to watch a movie about how someone does a film about how women are exploited by, well, not just men, but like in industry, or, you know, Mulholland Drive, I think is a genuinely emotional film. Like there's the Club Silencio sequence in that, essentially is like a encapsulation of everything. Anyways, Hemant, do you have other defenses, or are you accepting that you have lost to us?
I'm not accepting defeat in any way. This is only, I'm only retreating for future victory. I think maybe I should reassess how people watch movies. But because like my, my, I mean, what I get out of it is mostly how he paces, at least for the rest of the movie. All the showy stuff kind of happens in the beginning of the movie, and then they have the one set piece of
audio. Yes, that is true.
But I think there is only mostly conversation scenes and conversation
All the conversation scenes are backloaded in the second act, meeting of the third act.
In the first act, there's like three conversations that happen which don't kind of, they kind of allude to the same kind of like, you headed this way. And
it's like watching a video game with the tutorial turned on. Now you're going this way, press the arrow towards the right.
That's but maybe the that maybe the vicious the most vicious insult I've heard subjected at a Kubrick film. But yes, okay.
I don't know that as someone who actually I don't find this movie boring. I don't know why people find them boring.
The only one, to me, the pacing is, like, to me, the runtime of this definitely, I was just like...
I think I felt the runtime more than anything else. That's a bigger issue I have. Again, it has too many good things for this movie to completely outright bash it to something unwatchable.
It's too well made.
Kubrick's first movie. What was the name of that first movie? I forgot also.
Fear and Desire.
Thank you. It's not Fear and Desire.
Yeah, well, very few things are.
Yes.
I think Kubrick would also know that.
Yes.
But no, I do think it's one of his weaker works, though. Even though I would want to. Yeah.
What?
This was Hemant making that. What do you think is his weakest work?
His weakest work is Particles. Easy.
No, Fear and Desire, Spartacus, and then I would say
Fear and Desire, Spartacus. Maybe... Killer's Kiss is also quite weak. I don't like Killer's Kiss.
Killer's Kiss, but I think it's still decent.
I like. Don't you dare say The Killing. I actually like The Killing.
The Killing I love.
But to me, this is like closer to his to lower rate tier.
Let me check my rankings of all the Kubrick movies. I think I have ranked them. Wait, hold on. Let me check. I'm not trying to be a contrarian or trying to lambast a great...
A lot of people didn't like Eyes Wide Shut when it released. Now it has this glowing reputation as a...
People look at some of David Lean's later work and say, okay, he's still great and stuff.
There's like redeemable stuff like that. I don't think it's a bad movie at all. Like, I just think it's got its limitations for me. It's the big thing. To me, I told you, it's like David Lynch minus...
minus all the psyche stuff.
I'm a big David Lynch fan, so I'll say, this is all psyche. This is nothing but psyche.
I haven't seen his three shorts, right? So other than that, there are 13 features more or less.
Yes.
So 10 is Eyes Wide Shut, 11 is Spartacus, 12 is Killer's Kiss, 13 is Fear and Desire.
Okay. So maybe something like that only. It's also like the first three for me are like so monumental that I don't know how.
I think it's first four for me. 2001, Dr. Strangelove, Barry Lyndon, and then The Killing.
Okay.
5 is Clockwork Orange. So it's like I love The Killing more than Clockwork Orange.
It's not The Shining. I mean, okay.
No, The Shining has jumped up for me. So I have.
Shining
lots to is say
7.
About that.
I think Shining and Paths of Glory have the same rating for me, more or less.
I actually rate Eyes Wide Shut way more than Strangelove, actually. Even of the cultural significance and stuff, just for watching.
I think Strangelove is maybe my first. Maybe. Whoa. Yeah, or second, I'm not sure. Okay. Yeah.
2001, come on. Like,
2001 is the first.
Let me rewatch it. I watched 20 minutes and I was like, we could talk about the whole 20 minutes for the 2 hours. But yeah, I mean, it's probably going to be number one, but I'm just putting it as of now for number two because I rewatched Strangelove recently.
As a Kubrick movie, it's a Kubrick movie. So
it is, and there's no denying
Any way you crack it, there are interesting bits here again and again. Nobody can make Warners quite like Kubrick does. So
there's a lot of great camera work in this.
Yeah.
So I love the repeated music, not the tan, not that one. I like the waltz, the one with the Shostakovich one, I think, if I'm not wrong.
I think so, yeah.
But the tan thing gets quite repetitive. It's like there throughout in the second half. Like every time You look at Tom Cruise's face, that music
stuff. You just remember it from now on. From the same notes coming in Mission Impossible are going to get warped.
Yes.
Switch off the music. Yes, switch Christopher McQuarrie, do that.
I also like that sequence between him and Sidney Pollack in the second half. Entire sequence in the billiards room.
Where he is basically lording over him. It's the flip of the scene in the bathroom, right? The
beginning,
yeah.
Where it coked up Sidney Pollack and killed essentially
rid of her body. Yeah.
Yeah,
that reminded me of Babylon a lot, like the beginning of Babylon.
Hey, beginning of Babylon is more, you know, in your face, literally. Yeah,
the whole movie is in your face, though, right? Yeah. Babylon is essentially like a coked up dream, essentially, sort of like that.
Which is great. Yeah, this is more movies like that, please. More movies.
You don't like Mother. I've told you.
Saltburn is exactly like that. Yeah.
No, that is.
Sir, really. Saltburn is not like that. Come on.
Saltburn is a bit boring.
Saltburn has pretension within the coked up test.
Found Saltburn very boring. I was like, this is not a movie.
Which is not something I would expect to say. I was very excited to see Barry Keoghan and something headlining something because I do.
Sir, director bhool gaye na. Aap promising young woman dekhe.
I don't hate that movie. I don't hate that movie.
That whole movie bakwas hai. That is the first time. That is the first time that A24 ka sheen completely removed from my face. I'm like,
was that A24? Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh. But Saltburn is A24 or Neon.
Saltburn is Neon, yeah.
No. Anyways, why have we gone to Emerald Fennel from Kubrick?
It's very mostly weird. It's mostly the
rich people aesthetic.
Yeah, the evoking of, like, you know, it's again, it's not rich, rich ass. There is no power play in this movie enough to show that it's a rich versus poor narrative.
It's a
gender, like, it's either a gender thing or a marriage thing for me, like a marriage story.
Definitely, it is a marriage story. What
is it? Yeah, marriage story, divorce story.
When he walks into the orgy scene,
it's Kramer versus Kramer. No,
to me, the comparison pieces to this are Phantom Thread and Gone Girl. Those are the better ones. And I feel those are better a lot because they actually center a lot on the women of those films, which is weird because, like, you know, I think should have been used here.
Honestly, if this were a reverse scene of, like, him being
but that's a given that men are turkey, right? That's the whole scenario.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, but if this were supposed to reveal anything or, like, have a commentary on, like, something that's new or they wanted to show both the sides, I think her having her own journey parallelly to him would have been actually.
She's too sidelined in this, I feel. Like, she's a little too sidelined. I feel
like that was a very weak decision in terms of putting.
I think Kubrick probably was like. But to be very honest, I do, whatever the point is, I do remember Kidman more than Cruise in this. So, whatever that means, you know, it's the. Because she gets the bigger.
The information. That's why she is the river sticks ka Charon. Like, she's kind of like. Helping him along it's I read it from my Amar Chitra Katha version of the Odyssey. I really liked that no one kind of gave him a clear answer until he talks to her directly.
She tells him, which is
the whole thesis of a marriage anyway, right? If you're going
it is. The wife is always right, right? Right. Yes.
The husband says after confessing.
Yes.
First off, they're all people. They're blue coded. Too much blue coding. That was the whole thing.
Anyways, I think. I really like the title, by the way. I think it's a really good title of a film. Even though I always get to make the eyes wide shut joke, which I won't now because I do like.
Refer to a song by a band called Eyes Wide Open. I don't remember the name of the band, but I remember the song.
I love the opening image of the whole because it opens with like a guy almost provocatively looking at a woman undressing, and then the film just cuts to black. Like, that's his, like, great editing stuff, which he does even in the beginning is, like, super.
Yes.
He does this. They try to have a statement shot of, like, him walking and stuff. And then he kind of, like, tries to break the illusion of it being a statement. Like, It happens in the orgy scene a lot, where he kind of can see the yearning in his eyes, and then they cut to like him not being able to be a part of it, having to answer for himself.
Yeah, that's everything stops him. Like that's either him becoming or him being the pious man who's like, I will not engage in this, or it's like
which in a I think quote unquote lesser movie. Could have been funny.
You would.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Could have been funny.
I mean,
funny.
This is the thing is
that Bo is afraid, Amartya. Maybe try that.
No, thank you. Bo is afraid. Bo is afraid is the other end of the spectrum. That is the prime example of main making movies. Main making movies without going to therapy.
You triggered him now, right?
Yeah.
supposed to be trigger warning in the beginning.
Yeah, I should have. I should have
said. Mentioned Bo is afraid.
You didn't talk in the episode with Bo is afraid, right? Amartya, you didn't come for that, right?
No, I didn't because I hadn't seen it.
Okay,
I was so mad after watching that movie and listening to the podcast. Sanjit saying this movie is interesting. I'm like, Barmecha.
Even Hemant likes it.
Yeah, it is interesting. It is something like it's. I mean, you don't find. This is not the scale of the movie. The scale that he was trying to go for is not. Like it's not
the scale of the therapy session is amazing.
So great. And that was my favorite scene. That's the whole part of that's the best movie. That's the best.
I just think it's so cobbled together of a lot. Because the issue is he like listed all of his influences before, and I'm not the biggest Ari Aster fan. So I made a deal of actually doing more effort and watching his inspirations. Because I was like, you know, let me get into his work more because everyone likes him. I like 3/4 of Hereditary a lot. So you know, I don't like the last 4th, but yeah, that's okay. Midsommar, I
don't
know
why people. Even the first time I watched it, I was like, okay, I'm not gonna like this.
I like Hereditary a lot. I also like Midsommar.
You like Midsommar, so yeah, you guys. Yeah, I really don't like Midsommar. I think it's like boring, like really boring. But anyways, I tried to get myself more into his filmography, and then I realized that all of his influences are very good. His movie though is not. You know, so that's the issue. Sometimes
you're being very kind. His movie is a turd. You're being very kind.
Fine. We will cut this because you're just insulting Stanley Kubrick. So, anyways, yes, we are done, Hemant. We see the message.
Done. Yeah, we are.
You have to do your duties.
You have to do your duties.
It's actually my duty of getting rid of my driving responsibility. I just want her to have a license so that she can drive me around all the time.
Nice. So you she can drive you around to that mansion that is across town, right? Like in Eyes Wide Shut.
She's I'm right here. You know my motive.
I think your reputation's anyways spoiled. So it's
at this point,
yes. Yeah.
If Dhruv doesn't cut anything from the podcast, your reputation is definitely.
I will not be cutting any of the marriage-related jokes, anniversary, and Eyes Wide Shut-related jokes. So yes, that's all going to stay. But yes, I think we've covered a lot extensively on these films. Hopefully you found it both entertaining, illuminating, and not as boring as Amartya found Eyes Wide Shut. Hopefully we weren't as repetitive and made the same points again and again in terms of, you know, a lot of the stuff we said, which I realized I just said, and then I said, I hope we weren't repetitive, which canceled itself out. Anyways, doesn't matter. We are finishing off for today. Thank you so much for listening. Our next episode is probably going to be 2001 A Space Odyssey and Artificial Intelligence, AI by Steven Spielberg. So you'll have the same crew, Hemant, Amartya, and myself. You can follow each of us on our Instagram handles and Letterboxd. I will put all the links in the description. But I especially thank you for people who told us that they really enjoyed this Kubrick episode and wanted it to be back.
Yeah,
we thought no one was listening, which is also the reason why we stopped.
We feel like SETI sending out signals for some aliens.
Yes. I'm very excited to now talk about that one monumental film also, because we're just focusing one monumental film. I think
the amount of times we referenced Odyssey today without referencing 2001 is something.
Yeah. Yeah, but yeah. So yes, but thank you so much for listening to this episode, and khatam.